It's time to strike up the band and get ready for some football. Tuskegee, Alabama State, the Turkey Day Classic is next. Americana football on Thanksgiving. As a kid, you're taught this day is about friends, family, and football. As a kid in Central Alabama, you're taught this day is about this game, the Turkey Day Classic, and we are live. CSTV, Montgomery, Alabama. Hello, everybody. HBCU football presented by the U.S. Navy. I am Jonathan Coachman, and I tell you what, if your family is anything like mine, you're just sitting down after turkey and stuffing, ready for some football, and that's where we come in. We're live at the Crampton Bowl for the 83rd straight time. Tuskegee and Alabama State set to do battle on Thanksgiving Day. Let's bring in now my tag team partner, Chris Ricks. And Chris, these are two teams that are separated by less than an hour's drive, and they flat out don't like each other.
Yes, two teams from two different conferences, but this truly is the battle for Interstate 85. A lot of tradition between these two teams. When we talk about classics, there's so many of them, but this game, the oldest classic game in the country, and you talk about tradition, one guy that knows it is head coach for Tuskegee, Willie Slater. When he was hired 1 year ago to coach this Tuskegee team, he was asked one simple question. Can you beat Alabama State? He's been reminded of that question throughout the season by fans and alumni, so a lot of pressure on both teams, but especially both head coaches.
And if Willie Slater, Chris, wants to get his first win over Alabama State, he's going to have to rely on his prolific offense, 42 points 1 week ago, and he's led by a very veteran quarterback, Kevin Huff.
Yes, he is. A very solid veteran quarterback in Kevin Huff. A runner and a thrower, very hard to defend for opposing defenses. But when he throws the ball, has two very talented wide receivers in Jason English and Lorenzo Crawford. Also with Fitzhugh in the backfield, a somewhat balanced offense, but at the end of the day, a very explosive offense.
You know, in the past, it's been all about the Alabama State offense as well, but this year it's about the Alabama State defense. They're going to need a big day this afternoon.
Yes, the number two defense in the SWAC conference in total defense, and they're led by linebacker Chris Dupuy. Very talented, two-time defensive player of the week in the SWAC conference, and in last year's Turkey Day Classic, 10 tackles alone. So if I'm Tuskegee, I'm staying away from linebacker Chris Dupuy.
You don't have to ask these two teams if they're ready. That's why you come to these two schools. Turkey Day Classic kickoff is next.
Football's
HBCU football presented by the U.S. Navy. Tuskegee and Alabama State is brought to you by the U.S. Navy. Navy, accelerate your life. By Aflac. Aflac, ask about it at work. By Publix, where shopping is a pleasure. And by Nissan, proud presenter of the 2006 Heisman. Visit theheismanvote.com to cast your votes. Welcome back, everybody, to Montgomery, Alabama. We are certainly excited to be here this afternoon, the 83rd annual Turkey Day Classic, and certainly the bands are a huge part of this day. Alongside Chris Ricks, Jonathan Coachman, we are just about set for kickoff. And we're going to have a near-capacity crowd here this afternoon on an absolutely spectacular day for football in Alabama.
And I'm telling you, the tradition between both of these teams, you can't explain it in words. Even last year's game, coming down to 1 point, ASU going into overtime, going for two, not getting it, losing by one to Tuskegee. And trust me, they want their revenge today.
28-27 was your final 1 year ago in overtime. And certainly, if today's game is anything like a year ago, we are in for a special treat. So sit back, rub the full belly, settle in, because we're here to work for you this afternoon. CSTV, HBCU football presented by the U.S. Navy, Tuskegee, and Alabama State. And in true HBCU fashion, they just kind of start the game when they feel like it.
Well, definitely. I think they're still waiting on a couple fans to get here. Obviously going to be a packed house today. Still a few empty seats, but once this thing gets underway, it's going to be exciting.
Real quick, Chris, your Rick's report on today's game.
Well, first of all, for ASU, they have to execute offensively. They have to protect the ball for both quarterbacks. And as far as the defense, you have to contain Kevin Huff. Limit the big offensive plays from this Tuskegee offense. If you look at the other side of the ball in Tuskegee, you have to contain Jay Peck. He's averaging almost 100 yards per game on the ground, and that will force ASU's quarterbacks to beat you, whether it be Ingram or Woods today.
Tuskegee has won the toss. They have elected to receive. Back to receive for Tuskegee. Ashun Jackson, 5'8", 170-pound senior, and also number 29, Tony Fornick, will take the kickoff from Alabama State, and the ball is on the tee, and we are just about set. And Chris, I can't even tell you how excited I am today.
Oh, I'm telling you, the weather, the atmosphere, the rivalry, and the tradition between these two teams, this is what college football is all about.
And here we go, end over end kick, come down to Jackson at the five, and he's gonna take it straight up the middle, and he's gonna be dragged down at the 22, and that is where Tuskegee will take over on offense. And the man Kevin Huff, will lead the charge.
And we'll take a look here at Kevin Huff, two-year starter at quarterback, the transfer from Jones Community College in Mississippi. He's a leader, he's a playmaker, and he's the reigning SIAC Player of the Week. 335 yards of total offense and four touchdowns last week in a big victory against Lane College.
And we had Lane College earlier this year, and they're a team that scored a lot of points as well. And so to see that score surprised me a little bit. And I am very excited to see this Alabama State offense, to see how far they've come since we had them earlier this year as well. So first down and 10 at the 23 of Tuskegee. And what do you know? First play of the game, and a flag goes flying. So I'm going to be your referee microphone here this afternoon and the legal presenter. And real quick, let's take a look at the offensive lineups for Tuskegee today. And we talked about the big offensive line that will have to block for Kevin Huff and his talented wide receivers and running back Richard Fitzhugh. Keep your eye, guys, on number three, the eye back in the backfield. And again, another flag flies, and again, a little bit too early, a little bit too much excitement, I think, to start the game.
And that's where you talk about the tradition of this game, the fans, the crowd. You talk to both coaches, talk to both of them this week, and they said the most important thing is for both of these teams to block out the environment and focus on the details. Right now, they're not doing that.
Hey, look at the offensive line, and then you look at the backs and receivers, and you mentioned Crawford and English. Those are two guys, number eight and number nine, that will get a lot of action here this afternoon.
Eight combined touchdowns through the air this year for both of those receivers, and you talk about the offensive line, not one senior starter on the offensive line, but they have gotten better throughout the season.
Well, so far, Tuskegee has not run a play, and they've lost 7 yards. So first down and 17, the ball is back at their own 13, excuse me, first down and 20. And not exactly the way that Tuskegee and Coach Willie Slater would like this game to have started. Kevin Huff takes it from the shotgun, and he's got a lot of room straight up the middle, gets tripped up as he lands at the 20. And let's take a look at the Alabama State defense. These are the guys that will have to control Kevin Huff.
Very talented, number two in the SWAC conference in total defense, as we talked about in the open. Number two also in the conference in pass defense. So you've got a very talented defensive line, secondary linebackers, but you talk about the secondary, might be the best defensive backfield in ASU history.
And the first play, Chris Dupuy was the man who made the first tackle of the game, and we mentioned a year ago had 10 big tackles against Tuskegee in the Big Turkey Day Classic. Now second down, and they will swing it out of the backfield at Fitzhugh. And Fitzhugh gets up past the 25. The clock continues to roll. He'll get tackled at the 27. That'll bring up a third down and about six for Tuskegee.
And this Hornet defense is going to be tested today. They almost gave up an 18-point lead last week to Mississippi Valley State. Got out of that game with a 25-20 victory, but again, almost gave up a huge lead. So they've got to show consistency throughout the day and not allow this high-powered Tuskegee offense to operate comfortably.
And now Tuskegee will come out with four wide receivers. They love to spread out the field. They love to throw it around and really get everybody involved in the offense. Kevin Huff now barking out signals. Alabama State appeared to have jumped off sides. He'll get it out to Fitzhugh. And Fitzhugh trying to get around the corner. And he may have just enough for the first down. But, of course, flag down on the play, and we'll see what the call is.
And that's where Kevin Huff is using that hard cadence. That's where you see the Alabama State defense jumping there. He gets two hard cadences that draws him offside. We'll see if they got a free play.
And indeed they do. And the mark was enough for a first down, so the penalty is declined. It'll be first down for the Tigers.
And we'll take a look here. Right there, he's saying, Hutt, drawing the defense off sides, but it's on two, and they're trying to anticipate that cadence right now. You've got to be more disciplined if you're on the Hornet defense and not fall for that hard cadence from Kevin Huff.
So despite the two initial penalties on the Golden Tigers, they are able to get enough for the very first down, and they're all the way up at the 33. We're just getting started in the first quarter, 12-10 and counting, as Tuskegee and Alabama State are scoreless. And again, Alabama State appears to have jumped off sides. Flag does come in, and Kevin Huff has stood up at the line of scrimmage. But, you know, Chris, if indeed, well, it doesn't even matter if this is on Alabama State, five penalties in the first seven plays. This could be a long afternoon for us.
And again, that's where we talk about the discipline. Both teams right now being very undisciplined, and I guarantee you, defensive coordinator for Alabama State, Tony Pierce, not happy with his defensive line. He wants them to be watching the ball, not listening to the quarterback's cadence.
And I guess you can kind of understand the excitement and the nervousness, but you also want the players, once you get on the field, you played a lot of big games. You got to let that all subside and play the game.
And it's tough. It's much easier said than done. And talking to both coaches this week, again, they say the number one thing we want from our players is for them to block out this environment and focus on the details. Right now, they're just not doing that.
First down and five. Huff will go back to pass. And he throws it off, and it appears to be intercepted. We'll see what they call. And they are going to call it an interception. And Alabama State with the first turnover of the game. It was tipped by Chris Dupuy. And we'll take a look at it, see if indeed it was, and a quick look at the replay, but it doesn't matter. They called it an interception, and we'll go the other way.
Well, first of all, bad decision from Kevin Huff trying to get this thing away. It looked like it hit the ground, but we'll see if Desmond Foster came up with the interception right there. That looks like it bounced off the ground. You've got to get a better call from that, from this officiating crew. Big break for Alabama State.
But keep in mind, it's only at the Division I-A level that they have instant replay,
yep.
So we're not going to have it here today, so it doesn't matter. Alabama State does get the interception, and we'll take a look at the starting lineup right after this first play. The first one up the gut, good for 2 or 3 yards. And let's take a look at that Alabama State offense, an offense that will have to take advantage of field positions such as this.
And they're led by quarterback Alex Ingram. 6 touchdowns, 4 interceptions through the air, 5 touchdowns rushing. He's been a little erratic this year, but he is still the engine for this offense. If he plays good, this Alabama State team plays good. So it's critical that he gets off to a good start today.
Second down and 7 for Alabama State and Alex Ingram. Shotgun handoff again, straight up the middle to Jay Peck, who is a guy that, in all likelihood today, Chris, will go over the 1,000-yard mark.
Yes, just needs 11 yards. He's at 989 to get over that 1,000-yard mark. And we take a look here at the offensive line. Fairly young, not a lot of veterans on this offensive line. But if you look at the backs, Jay Peck, the backbone, really, of this offense, he's got to play well. And then very talented wideouts in Hoffman and Horst. Ingram has to be efficient and get his playmakers the ball. And again, we talked about it earlier, protect the ball. Turnovers have been big for this offense and has hurt them. They've got to protect it today.
Third down and 5. 4 wideouts for Ingram. Back to pass. Good protection. He's got a man over the middle, throws it a little bit too high. It was intended for number 1, Brandon Horace. Horace was open. The pass was not there. It'll bring up an interesting fourth down decision, as Alabama State does not have that much distance in their kicking game.
Well, and Alex Ingram has to keep his eyes down the center of the field. He had his flanker, Lorenzo Hoffman, down at the bottom, wide open on a one-on-one coverage to the left of your screen, and he keeps his eyes to the right. You see, he's not looking down the center of the field, tries to hit Horace with a high pass, missed a big opportunity there for this Hornet offense.
It would have been a 44-yard field goal attempt, but instead, Charles Coe and the Alabama State team decides to go for it, and a bad snap. The ball's on the ground, and this one will turn over on down. So Alabama State unable to take advantage of the first turnover of the game, and Tuskegee certainly dodges a bullet.
Well, Coach Coe, we took a look at him right there. Not very confident in their kicking game. It's been up and down throughout the season. They choose to go for it, really nothing to lose, but you see the turnover on downs.
Remaining here in the first quarter. Both teams have had the ball once. Both teams have turned the ball over. An interception and a turnover on downs. And Tuskegee's will get their second opportunity at their own 29. Alabama State a few moments ago certainly squandering a golden opportunity after the interception. So Kevin Huff will hand off to Fitzhugh straight up the middle for a couple. And And Chris, the interception by Kevin Huff in their first possession, very uncharacteristic of this veteran quarterback.
Yes, especially with the way their season has gone. They've had a very solid season, and that's because of they've got off to great starts throughout the season. This is a team that has already accepted an invitation to play in a bowl game, the Pioneer Bowl. So I talked to Coach Slater and asked, what is the motivation for this game? He said, we don't have to get them up for this one. Because of the game, because of this rivalry, and looking at the start of the game, they've got to make better decisions, especially for Kevin Huff.
Second down, Huff back to pass. Alabama State bringing a lot of guys, and the pass is there. It's complete. Up to number five, excuse me. And Tuskegee, a big play on second down. It's good for a first down. Jakari Atkinson. Now first down at 10 for Tuskegee up near midfield.
Nice job, little play action here from Huff. Setting up, he's got a one-on-one route down below on the deep out route and a nicely delivered pass. That's where you want to have it, out on the boundary, waiting on your receiver where it's us or nobody. You leave that ball behind, and there's a chance for that corner to pick that ball off.
So first down at 10, right at midfield. Kevin Huff back to pass. He's got plenty of time, and he's got a man out there. And again, it's complete all the way inside the 25, down to the 23. And again, that man number five, Jakari Atkinson, on the pitch and catch. And just like that, Tuskegee, we talked, they're explosive. And those two big plays, and now they're down deep in Alabama State territory.
And we'll take a look at it here again. Now you've got Huff in the shotgun. He's got a one-man route. You see some of the pressure there. He gets it off just in time to Atkinson on a corner route. You've got one-on-one coverage. And when you have that kind of coverage out there, even with the cornerback, you take it a little high angle, and Huff delivers it right on the spot.
27 yards on the last play, and the ball is marked at the 23 of the Hornets. Three wide receivers for Kevin Huff. They're going to run it back to Fitzhugh, and Alabama State was ready. Number 22, that's Rashard Johnson. He was the man there. He was ready, and a big loss for Tuskegee.
Surprised to see Tuskegee and offensive coordinator Coach Slater go to the run game there. You see back-to-back big passing plays. I think you're going to have to stick with the aerial attack right now if you're going to want to get in that end zone. We've taken a look at the defensive line and the linebacker core for Alabama State. They're very fast. They pursue quickly. You've got to keep it on the edges and keep working that passing game.
An 8-yard loss for the Golden Tigers back to the 31. Huff back to pass. Again, he's got plenty of time. He floats it over the middle. He's got a man out there, and it's a touchdown. Jason English, 31 yards for the score, and the Golden Tigers strike first. English beat his man, and Kevin Huff put plenty of air under the football. And it was a 31-yard scoring touchdown, and Tuskegee is off and flying.
And this is where you're saved by the coverage. One-on-one coverage, even though Huff gets hit, he gets the ball off, and it gives English a chance to get it because there's no safety back deep.
A late flag came in, and now they're saying there are an illegal man downfield. So that touchdown is going to come back. I apologize. That flag came in late. There was some discussion by the officials down on the field. They decided that an illegal man was downfield, so call the touchdown back. They'll mark it off 5 yards. And so what a huge break for Alabama State.
Exactly. What a huge break for this Hornet defense right there. We're seeing penalties already playing a huge factor in this ballgame, especially for Tuskegee. They've got to get regathered and focus and eliminate the penalties because it's killing their offense right now.
So they move it back to the 36. It'll bring up a second down and long. They need to get all the way down to the 13-yard line for a first down. So the immediate elation is called back. Kevin Huff a little bit too high out on the far side of the field. Incomplete, third down.
I think that was a smart decision by Kevin Huff. He saw the coverage very tight on his wide receiver, chooses to throw that ball away, live to play another down, not force a turnover when you're approaching your opponent's red zone. Again, I think this is a good decision by him right here, recognizing the coverage, and again, we see that pressure in his face, not able to step through into that pass.
but safe, not throwing interception on that play.
And Chris, we talked about the quick, fast defense of Alabama State, and in the first quarter, they're bringing a lot of guys, five, six, seven guys, and allowing their D-backs to have one-on-one coverage. So now third down and long, and Alabama State again jumps offside. So Kevin Huff is going to keep it. He's still on his feet, gets down to the 31, and all kinds of laundry on the field. And needless to say, this has not been the cleanest start to a football game.
Well, I'm telling you right now, both coaches for these teams frustrated with their players because of all the penalties. I'm telling you, they're going to hear it at a timeout. Watch the ball and eliminate the dumb penalties.
So the offside is called on the Hornets, so they'll march off five the other way. And really, when you think about a prolific offense, you can use penalties to get yards. I guess that's one way. You know, I hate to tease about it, and certainly Charles Coe and Willie Slater aren't too happy about the penalties to start the game, but you got to make some type of light of the situation. So now we mark off five, and it'll bring up a third down, and heck, long, 23 yards to go. For 18 now, there you see Willie Slater, a very successful first campaign as a head man at Tuskegee.
He's done a great job really resetting the mindset and the mentality of this Tuskegee University ball club. 7-3 in his first season. Not bad for a first season head coach.
Not bad at all. And a bowl game to boot. So now Kevin Huff, he's going to go deep. He's got a man down the far sideline and just a little bit too far. It was intended down there for Jakari Atkinson. He had him open. He had his man beat, but just a little too much oomph on that pass by Kevin Huff.
And that's where Jakari Atkinson has to get there. Huff does a nice job putting enough air on that pass. You don't want to float it up there too much and risk the interception. I think this is a nicely thrown ball, and Atkinson has to get there, get his head up a little earlier, and get to that ball.
So now Tuskegee will be forced to punt, and Christopher Kahn is the man to do the honors, and a pooch punt. And this one's going to come down and caught inside the three. And that's where they're going to down it. So a great pooch punt, great coverage down there by Kevin Washington. And that's where Alabama State will take over for their second possession of the afternoon. We're going to take a timeout on the field. So far, it's all about field position. We are back live in Montgomery, Alabama, the 83rd annual Turkey Day Classic. And you look at the history, all but 5 years of the 83 years, it's been Tuskegee and Alabama State.
And I'm telling you, we talk about the tradition of this game, teams that have played in this game, a lot of history. We take a look at there at some of the teams, and I'm telling you, you'd have a lot of classic games played throughout the country, especially here in the South. But this game, the Turkey Day Classic, the oldest one in the country.
Alabama State takes over at their own three, and they hand off to Peck. Straight up the gut, he may get one. And what a great pooch punt that Tuskegee just had, Mr. Christopher Kahn. And so now Alabama State, if they want to score the first touchdown of the game, will have to go 97 yards to do it. And really, Tuskegee, very disappointed, you got to believe, after that touchdown was called off the board.
Yes, and you take a look at this Alabama State offense with Ingram, might see Tchepio Woods in there today. Both quarterbacks been erratic this year, and also injuries, and Alabama State has had a tough time this year replacing Tavares Jackson, a three-year starter, was drafted in the second round of last year's draft. Let's see if they can get it done today and find some consistency here in this ballgame.
Peck gets the call again. He'll go over the five and up to about the seven or eight and gets gang tackled there. And he'll bring up another third down. And really, Chris, this is you need to make these third down opportunities, because right now it has been all about field position.
Well, especially, like you said, especially when you're back up against your own end zone, you don't want, even if you punt, you're going to give Tuskegee good field position. So you want to convert, put a drive together. That's something we haven't really been able to see from either team yet, is sustain a drive and start building some confidence in their offense.
Four wide receivers for the Hornets. And they run a wide receiver screen, a good call, and plenty of room, and still on his feet, up past the 20 to the 23, and now finally taken down at the 25. And that was a good, safe play call, and that was completed to number 13, James Cray. And Cray gets all the way up to the 25 and a big, much-needed first down for the Hornets.
And Cray's someone who's been really not looked at a lot this year. Has three touchdowns on the year, and you see the moves there. Just give the guy the ball with the misdirection, the little bubble screen the other way, picks up some nice blocks, and then it's all number 13 making some plays and picking up the first down.
So now a big first down up at the 25, and Ingram from the shotgun again. He throws it out to the near side, completed, and immediately taken down. The big tight end, big number 85 right there, is Clifton Cotton Jr. And he's taken down immediately by the hard-hitting Albert Booker Jr. So Jr. takes down Jr.
Well, you'd like to see Ingram come out to Cotton a little bit earlier. He went inside, came outside, then came back to his tight end. I think he should have hit him on the first read. Might have given his tight end a little more time to catch that ball and roll up the sideline. Came a little late out there, results in a loss on the play.
And folks, SWAC is the sponsor of the first and 10 line for today's game. Always pleased and honored to have SWAC a part of the broadcast. So now second down for Alex Ingram. And he avoids a couple of tacklers. I think it's taken down from behind. Some nifty feet right there. And some great behind the play tackling of big number 44. Let's call him Willie Akron for the day. How about that?
Well, a nice play by Ingram. Looked like he lost his footing a little bit there. This is a new service. Very nice, that new kind of artificial turf right there. Tries to make another move here at the end. Slips a little bit, but at the end of the day, a nice run. He's going to have to pick up a lot more of those big plays with his feet today and not rely just on the passing game.
And another late flag came down on the play. They'll march it back all the way back to the 23. And it was holding on Alabama State. So I think that everybody got kind of a slow start today. Got an early lunch, and they said, okay, now we'll kind of mosey into the game, kind of slow-mo into it. So all the way back, they mark it all the way back to the 13 now. So Alabama State second down and 22. And there you see already eight penalties in this first quarter as we approach 3:45 and counting in the first stanzas. Now Ingram from the shotgun, he's got plenty of room, plenty of time, fires it over the middle, and this one is incomplete. Intended that time for number 10, Lorenzo Hoffman. And we talked about Ingram this year being very inconsistent, and that's why you've seen Tuskegee Woods from time to time for Alabama State.
Yes, Ingram has a wide open square in right here, run by Lorenzo Hoffman, and you don't like to throw these passes high or late, but here you see he throws it too low, does not give his receiver in Hoffman a chance to catch that football. And when those linebackers vacate and you have a wide open square and on the backside, you've got to hit those in this ballgame.
And the nickname for Lorenzo Hoffman is Slim. We'll go with that today too. We're hip, we're cool, we like to get it done. Alex Ingram now, again, plenty of time. He's got a man over the middle. It's juggled a little bit, but then it's caught by number 17, Antonio James, but it's going to be well short of a first down, and Alabama State will be forced to punt.
And that's where the missed opportunity comes into play. On the last play, missing that squaring, you pick up a nice gain on this play, but still not enough to get that first down. Nice execution there, picking up yards, but again, just not enough. That's where they have to execute on the big plays and not give up those big opportunities.
Anthony Johnson to punt for Alabama State, and back to return, A'Shaun Jackson for Tuskegee. Good snap, and the kick is end over end, and Johnson's gonna let it bounce, and it bounces past him, and a mistake will cost his team about 15 yards as the ball will roll dead and be down inside the 20 at the 18. We'll take another break. Still no score, but heck, the fans don't care. We'll be back.
On radio.
On a beautiful day in Montgomery, Alabama, the state capital, we've got 2:45 remaining here in the first quarter of the 83rd annual Turkey Day Classic, Alabama State and Tuskegee. And the Golden Tigers will take over from their own 18. Kevin Huff with the I formation and two wide receivers trying to get the first points on the board here this afternoon. Huff back to pass. He looks at his second option, nice pitch and catch. And that's completed out to number 32, his fullback, to Johnson Finley. And you talk about the first points on the board, Chris. Well, it's time to take a look at the Xbox Live Big Play Replay. And we'll take a look at that in a minute. But Kevin Huff, we've seen his strong arm.
Nice job by Huff getting it out in the flat, taking what the defense is giving him. Might have had a chance on that corner out up top, but had his fullback Finley wide open in the flat. Nice delivered pass. Nice gain for this Tuskegee offense.
And Kevin Huff now to the second man through. That's Fitzhugh. They only needed about one, and that's about all they got. And now, let's take a look at the Xbox Live Big Play Replay, the first touchdown that was called off the board.
And this is where penalties come into play. Big missed opportunities. Even though Huff had pressure on him, was able to get the ball off to English. You see it, it's a touchdown, but because of the holding, comes back, or because of the penalty, and that's where in a big game like this, you have to take advantage and not have those foolish penalties.
So far, it's been all about the penalties, backing both teams up, and taking the only touchdown off the board to this point. So now first down and 10. Just enough for the first down on that last run by Fitzhugh. So Tuskegee and Kevin Huff as the clock continues to run during a scoreless first quarter. Kevin Huff appears to be changing the play at the line of scrimmage and appeared to take too much time. And again, delay of game, we'll back it up 5. And this is really borderline unbelievable.
Well, I'm telling you, at Florida State, when you had penalties or we had miscues, we had to run stadiums. I don't know if either one of these teams has discipline for penalties and miscues, but if they do, both of these teams are going to have to do a lot of conditioning in the coming week.
Well, I'll tell you what, I may have to change my flight. First down, 15 for the Golden Tigers and Kevin Huff. Hopefully you guys are enjoying a beautiful Thanksgiving afternoon of football. Fitzhugh gets the toss, and look at the moves. And after all that, gets 2 yards. And Alabama State, we talked about how good they are, how ferocious they are on defense, and they really hit you hard and stick you when they do get their hands on you.
Well, you take a look there at linebacker Michael Figures. He is pumped up. You see Fitzhugh making a nice spin move, but Figures is right there to lay the wood on him and say, don't try that move in my linebacker area, my friend.
Are you using my lines again? Lay the wood? I have it patented.
I didn't know that was your line.
Yeah, it is. Not many people do. Second down, long for the Golden Tigers. Could be the last play of this first quarter. Shotgun. Alabama State again brings 6 or 7. And this time, Kevin Huff, he runs right into the waiting arm of big number 52, Nicklaus Grant. And so far, the Alabama State defense has been relentless. A huge loss on the play, and that indeed is the last play of this first quarter.
And this is where Kevin Huff's experience has to get him to step up in the pocket. He tries to escape out right there, and you see Grant has the angle on him. Do you see the pressure there in the pocket? Step up in the pocket and get outside. It's tough when you try to get outside the pocket and you have a fast defender like Grant in your face.
Well, it's been all about emotion, and it's been all about a little bit too much anxiety, too much anxious players, but hopefully they got it out of their system in the first quarter and we can get down to playing football in the second. A lot of penalties in the Turkey Day Classic. That's the end of the first quarter. Tuskegee will have a third down and long when we start the second. Stick around, everybody. Start of the second quarter. We are back in Montgomery, Alabama. Chris Ricks, Jonathan Coachman. We are live on CSTV, the 83rd annual Turkey Day Classic. You look at a shot of Charles Coe, the head man for Alabama State in his fourth season. And Tuskegee begins the second quarter, third down and forever. Kevin Huff being flushed out of the pocket. He'll be taken out of bounds up at the 15. And the obvious is well short of the first down. But taking a quick look at the Tuskegee side of things. And this is a school that is very rich in history. Founded in 1881, Dr. Booker T. Washington. And there you see some famous alumni, George Washington Carver. And their other big sport, they're very good men's basketball, 4 SIAC tournament championships. So now you can go back to the dinner table tonight and impress the folks about your knowledge of Tuskegee University. And a low punt will be picked up at midfield. Taken down at 45, so excellent field position. The coach's son, Michael Cope, on the return. So Alabama State will again have very good field position. And let's take a look at the Alabama State school profile. Enrollment exactly 5,442. Reverend John T. Porter, very influential and civil rights leader. And the big sport, the 2005 SWAC Women's Cross Country Champion.
find out all a lot of different things when you look at the school profile,
and,
Chris.
And you talk about Tuskegee, big men's basketball program, or basketball program, both teams, Tuskegee and Alabama State, men and women, play tomorrow night.
That's something that I did not know. Jay Peck gets the toss, and he tries to go up the middle. Nothing there. And bounces it to the outside and gets a couple. And speaking of basketball, quick little plug. I will be in Cincinnati tomorrow. Big game right here on CSTV. Louisville and Dayton. So we'll have that game tomorrow, 5 o'clock Eastern time, right here on CSTV. So you talk about a kid living his dream. I get the Turkey Day Classic today. Jump on a flight. We got Louisville and Dayton tomorrow.
But unfortunately, you'll be indoors. You will not have this kind of backdrop and this kind of weather, my friend.
This is pretty good stuff right here, no doubt about it. We're still scoreless in the second quarter. Four wideouts for Alex Ingram. Second down and 7. He fakes it to Peck. Drops back to pass. And again, all kinds of time. And he throws it into the end zone. He's got a man out there. And well defended in the end zone. And a flag does come in. It was intended for Lorenzo Hoffman. Justin Hanna was there on the defense. And it looked like pretty good position by Hanna. We'll have to take a look at the replay.
It did look like good position by Hanna. We'll talk about it in a second. Ingram got to take advantage of that one-on-one coverage and get the ball off earlier. Waited for Slim Hoffman to get into the end zone. He had Hanna beat early. You see him looking at the route, just waiting, and then throwing it late. You see him putting everything he has into that throw. I think if he throws it a hair earlier, it's not at the back of that end zone. It's more around the goal line, and Lorenzo Slim Hoffman has a better chance to catch that football.
Man, that's a tough call. This is a great replay right there, guys, by the way. And tough call against Tuskegee and Mr. Hanna, but the call is made. We move on. First down and 10 to 27. Take a look at the penalty. 10 through the first quarter in a couple of minutes. Jay Peck gets the call, and he'll be taken down at about the 25, a couple yards on first down. Well, you talk about a couple of big plays. We already looked at the Xbox big play replay in the first quarter, the touchdown taken off the board for Tuskegee, and then that on third down, that big defensive penalty against Tuskegee.
And I think Alex Ingram still trying to get settled in, let those nerves calm with this environment, playing in a very big game. Expect offensive coordinator Coach Coe for Alabama State to feed the ball to Jay Peck and try to get them closer into that red zone, sticking with their bread and butter.
So now 5 wideouts for Alex Ingram. He's got a man wide open on the near side, finally gets it to him. And a one-on-one tackle out there on Brandon Horace. And Horace does have enough for the first down, so Alabama State continues their drive.
Well, it looks like Ingram getting more settled into that position, and now as they approach, getting into the red zone, splitting everyone wide out, no backs. So Tuskegee know they're going to the air, drops everyone deep, and you see Ingram have Horace right out there in the flat, gives him a nice catchable ball. Horace making a nice move and picking up the first down.
Horace is the second leading receiver for Alabama State, right behind James Craig. He's got a couple of scores on the year. And Alabama State looking to get into the end zone for the very first time here today. Ingram again from the shotgun, again gives it to Jay Peck, gets past the first line of defense, inside the 5, and finally taken down at the 4. 13 yards on that carry, first down and goal, Alabama State.
And I'm telling you, Jay Peck, we talked about giving him the football. Second in the SWAC conference in rushing, averaging almost 100 yards per game at 98.9. He has been Mr. Dependable as far as the ground game goes for this Hornet offense. You give him the ball, he's going to get you at least 3 to 5 every time. And we see right there the power breaking through tackles and putting the Hornets in scoring position.
Jeremy Obi was the man that made the touchdown saving tackle for Tuskegee. But first down and goal, the ball marked just inside the 5. Ingram to Peck. Peck on his feet inside the 2. Continues to drive into the end zone for a touchdown. Jay Peck, 5 yards for the score, and Alabama State finally breaks the scoreless ball game.
And you can't say enough about this young man. We talk about him being second in the conference in rushing, also second in the SWAC conference in all-purpose yards, whether that be rushing, receiving, or even kickoff return at 119 yards a game. And you can see why. He is a playmaker fighting with that leg strength to get in the end zone.
Anthony Johnson on for the extra point. That is up. That is good. So after the great field position after the punt, Alabama State drives it 45 yards for the first touchdown of the game as Jay Peck shows why he is one of the premier running backs at Alabama State. There you see the hard lane drive. Alabama State leads it in the second by 7. Welcome back, HBCU football presented by the U.S. Navy. That man right there, Jay Peck, just went over for Alabama State to put them on top 7-0, Chris.
Well, Coach Co just going with a simple ISO right here up the middle, giving the ball to Jay Peck, and then you see him fighting, following his center, Darren Dunson, into the end zone. The leg strength, driving those legs. That's what any running backs coach tells his running back to do. Pump those legs, and you see the strength there, fighting to get in that end zone. But a nice job by the sophomore center leading the way for his running back.
Tony Forney and Ashun Jackson again back to receive the kick for Tuskegee. Jackson takes it at a 7, and he breaks it to the far side, and gets up past the 25 and finally taken down at the 26. So now Tuskegee, who last week jumped out to a 14-0 lead over Lane, finds himself this week behind 7-0, correct?
And this is where Kevin Huff has to step up. He knows he's the playmaker for this offense. Last year in this game, 122 yards passing, 151 yards running on the ground. And talking to Coach Coe, he said the difference was Kevin Huff. That's what he's got to become again in this ballgame, be the difference maker for his offense before Alabama State puts any more points up on the board.
And remember that the clock begins this year as soon as the ball is placed into play. So that's why the clock started right there. So now Kevin Huff, they bring in 6, Alabama State is. And he breaks out of the pocket and gets up past the 30 to the 32. And again, Aflac is the proud sponsor of the first and 10 line for today's game. It seems like as the year's gone along, I sound more and more like the Duck. I don't know what it is.
We see here Huff sitting in the pocket. He's got the routes opening up just because of the pressure. He's flushed out of the pocket and not enabling him to go through his reads. Goes on the ground. If he could have picked up a block right there, would have picked up the first down. The receivers for Tuskegee have to keep their eyes open, keep their head on a swivel, and watch when Huff is running, as he does run the ball a lot, and try to help their quarterback and pick up some blocks.
And the tackler on the play, Desmond Foster, was shaking up just a little bit. He's being helped off the field and moving back to action. While we have a quick second, I need to say happy Thanksgiving to my folks watching back in Salina, Kansas, and I'd be remiss, my beautiful fiance Amy watching in Pella, Iowa with the entire family on CSTV. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody. Wish I was there, but glad to be here. Second down and long. Kevin Huff keeps the ball, and the ball is on the ground, but I believe they're going to say down by contact. So a short gain on the carry. It'll bring up a third down and about 4. For the Golden Tigers.
Very nice of you, Coach, remembering the family.
I'm
remember the fiance
to.
Thanksgiving. Fortunately, yeah. Got my lovely wife here.
You're
with
lucky,
me.
You're lucky, man. You're
but,
lucky.
But have to wish a happy Thanksgiving to my family.
There you go.
Rick's family and Cena's family. Amy, happy Thanksgiving. We appreciate your support. You'll get to meet Amy someday. She is phenomenal.
I can't wait, man.
It's Anita's grandma.
Well, I told you. I know who it is. My question is, who makes the best gravy in our entire family? That's the discussion.
Ooh,
for the
we'll
second half.
We'll have to find out in the future,
we'll,
my friend.
We'll have to talk about it. So now, big third down play. Kevin Huff, they're bringing the house, but he's got a man wide open and all kinds of room. Fitzhugh on the far side, inside the 40. He cuts it back inside the 35. And a big play for Tuskegee, their biggest play of the day, and nobody was out there covering Fitzhugh.
And I'm telling you, blown coverage here, but that pressure from Alabama State almost prevents Kevin Huff from getting this ball off. And I'm telling you, with all that room out there, Fitzhugh would have been very frustrated if he did not get that pass from Kevin Huff. There's no one out there. Nice job getting it out to him in the flat, even with all that pressure from the Hornet defense. Big gain. You see a nice move there at the end of the run by Fitzhugh. Big first down for this Tuskegee offense. They needed that, and let's see if they can finish this drive and put some points on the board.
31 yards unofficially on that last play, and Tuskegee now into Alabama State territory. Kevin Huff fakes it to Fitzhugh this time. He's got a man open, and what closing speed, and an interception, I believe. Yes, indeed, Alabama State, and what a fantastic play on the far side. Number 19, Michael Coe, the coach's son, the transfer from the University of Arkansas. Another turnover, another interception for Kevin Hump.
And I'm telling you, I thought this play was wide open. I was watching the route out there develop the whole time. Thought it was going to be wide open on the boundary. And as soon as Hump released it, Michael Coe broke on this ball. And that's why you see he played at the University of Arkansas, who's in the SEC title game this year. Very talented. And that kind of breakaway speed is going to give him a chance to play at the next level.
And that ball was intended for number two, John Thomas, and he just stood there, waited for the ball to get to him. And when you do that, that is what happens. So a great interception by Michael Coe.
Well, it's tough because it's not a curl route. You're not coming back to the quarterback. You're having to wait there on the sideline, and right there, not much you can do. Huff's just got to get that ball out there a little bit quicker.
Chris, what do you know about throwing to wide receivers?
Not much.
I mean, you only played at Florida State, threw to a couple. You know, I mean, I'm begging you. Let me be the expert here. Second down, 8 for Alabama State. And there you see Kevin Huff over there discussing with his wide receivers and his offensive line exactly what went wrong. Again, deep into Alabama State territory. Again, another turnover. So far, Tuskegee and that high-powered offense has been kept off the scoreboard. This time, Alex Ingram, who can certainly run, and he runs powerfully up past the 40. The ball came out. We'll see if they called him down. I believe they did. And we mentioned the coach's son, Michael Coe. But let's talk about Charles Coe, the head man at Alabama State. Here's a guy certainly with a coaching pedigree. He's coached at Iowa. He's coached at Cincinnati. He's coached at Louisville, Missouri, Tennessee with Johnny Majors, and also Memphis. So the head man certainly knows how to get it done and has been very successful here at Alabama State as well.
And a very well-respected head coach just here in his fourth year. They've had an up-and-down year, but the kind of coach he is with his experience, and he's got great support from his administration and people that he works with.
So now Alex Ingram, after the big play, slips and just throws it up, and a bad decision. Intercepted by Tuskegee and then blasted out inside the 40. So the hitting has begun, but the interception, number 27, Jarrett Simpson, and he makes a nice return. So a bad decision. And there you see, trying to figure out, Charles Coe talking to Alex Ingram, what are you doing, kid?
Well, he's telling him, throw the ball away. And that's where the inexperience and inconsistency really comes in there for the sophomore quarterback, Alex Ingram. He's just got to eat this ball. You see him struggling with his footing there. You've just got to either throw it away or just tuck it and take the sack. He's not able to step into that ball. He just floats it up there, and that allows Gerard Simpson to intercept the ball.
Oh, baby, you can hear that one all the way up here, that even though there was the interception, you sometimes still got to pay the price. First down at 10 inside the 40, and Kevin Huff throws it, and that's going to be a pass interference. And number 4, Jimmy Toussaint, was just a little bit too early defending that one.
That's a tough play for Toussaint. He's just waiting there on the sideline, tries to close, but because of the timing and that comeback route, just waiting there, bumps the receiver a little bit too early, and that results in the pass interference.
And that pass appeared to be way too high, probably would not have been caught.
Can't review it.
Yeah, that's true. We'll take a look at it one more time.
See Huffier trying to go on the deep comeback. You mentioned, Coach, a little too high there, but you never know.
Yeah,
without
never
that
know.
Contact, might have been able to go up and get that ball.
That's certainly right. Jakari Atkinson again was the target. And it seems like this afternoon, number 4 has been looking for number 5 an awful lot. There you see the penalties today. And wow, we've had a bunch here in the first quarter and a half.
One-on-one coverage down below and up top.
Kevin Huff finds that one-on-one coverage, floats it into the end zone. Atkinson is out there. Atkinson, touchdown. A beautiful pitch and catch. 22 yards, Huff to Atkinson. You called it, you saw it, Chris. And they made Alabama State pay.
Well, I'm surprised to see the call by defensive coordinator for Alabama State, Tony Pierce, giving that kind of man coverage, a cover 4. No safeties back there, just man coverage on the outside. And you know that Coach Slater is going to take advantage of that because he has a talented quarterback and 2 very talented wide receivers. Nice pitch and catch, like you said, from Huff, going to his receiver, taking advantage of that one-on-one coverage.
And after the play, a Tuskegee player is down, an offensive lineman. And hopefully it's nothing it too serious. But Chris, we thought that we would see some points on the board. Quite frankly, we thought Tuskegee would be able to score today and Alabama State would have to stay up with them.
Well, they've been able to move the ball, but again, we've talked about it. It's been the penalties that have been killing them. Now they're starting to clean up their game a little bit, and then we'll take a look here at the replay. Huff delivering the ball. When you have that one-on-one coverage, you just have to take advantage, put it up there with a little air, and give your receiver a chance. We've talked about it all year. You want to give your receiver at least a jump ball, but not overthrow him and not take advantage of that one-on-one coverage. He does a nice job here delivering the ball to Atkinson, and then it's all number five going up and getting the catch before he falls out of the back of the end zone.
Yeah, and Atkinson is lucky right there that he didn't get a flag thrown on him for a little bit of showmanship. A little show me up, but to Atkinson did a great athletic job. You see right there tossing the ball to the defender, but did a great job of getting that first leg in and then securing the ball. And the man that is injured for Tuskegee is big number 66, Kevin Jones. Good to see him back and at least being helped off after the touchdown.
This is a very physical ball game. We've talked about the rivalry. We've talked about these teams. And you talk to Lorenzo Crawford, the split end for Tuskegee. He says, we're friends but enemies at the same time. A lot of these guys hang out, being that the universities are so close. They go out together. They spend time together. But when they play in this game, it is all physical and it is all business on the field.
Chris, now why'd you have to ruin it? I wanted to say that they don't like each other and they never see each other and they only meet once a year. And now they go out and they play, you know, have dinner and stuff. You know, it's all well and good. 45 miles is all that separates these two schools. It certainly has become a rivalry over the years that both teams look forward to, all the players do as well. It's a treat to be able to play on Thanksgiving Day, regardless of where you're playing at. So a 22-yard score, Huff to Atkinson, and Tuskegee comes right back to tie this one. I don't know about you, I'm having a heck of a time. We're in the second in Montgomery. The bands, an integral part of the Turkey Day Classic, which the HBCU football presented by the U.S. Navy. Tuskegee, just a moment ago, tying this one up at 7. So now Alabama State will get the ball back. Desmond Foster back to receive. He takes it at 5, and he'll go straight up the gut. And I saw that one from up here. The flags come flying in, and there was a huge block in the back. This one's going to go back 10. And I don't know why I think that we may have one big play, a kickoff, a punt, a touchdown that does not have a penalty on it. All right, now let's take a look at a program profile. It's different of Tuskegee. Certainly a team that we've talked about that has been around for a long time. They began play all the way back in 1894, but there you see 24 SIAC championships, 7 black college national championships. Look at that, 23 NFL draft picks. Huge number there. The all-time record, 586 wins for Tuskegee. Certainly down here in Central Alabama and the South, Tuskegee has a storied football tradition. Back to action, Jay Peck gets the call. And again, Tuskegee finds number 20 and holds him to just a couple of yards. So far, Jay Peck, despite the touchdown, has been pretty much held in check.
Yes, and expect Tuskegee to really key on Jay Peck right now. Shut down that running game and really put the pressure on Alex Ingram. We saw him in the last drive make a big mistake. They're going to want to put that game on his shoulders, shut down the running game, and see if the redshirt sophomore quarterback can make good decisions and beat them through the air.
And again, another flag down on the play, holding on Alabama State. Tuskegee does accept the penalty. So that will put the ball back inside the 5, and they'll replay first down and 15 for Alabama State. So if you think there's a lot of penalties today, you're not the only one. 6:18 remains here in the second quarter. First down and 13 for Alabama State. They hand off again to Peck. This time, he's able to find a hole straight up the middle. And it's taken down in the secondary, but not before he gets all the way up to the 15, a big gain on first down.
And if ASU can execute this run game with Tuskegee bringing an extra defender in the box and the defense trying to shut down that run game, if they can negate that and try to open up the passing game a little bit more for Alex Ingram, it'll make the young quarterback more comfortable and enable them to have more of a balanced offense. Right now, it's going to be all Jay Peck with Coach Coe not wanting his quarterback to make a big mistake deep in their own territory.
Jay Peck, 5'11", 207 pounds. He's a redshirt junior, and this time again, all kinds of room, and he's a nifty runner, making a couple of guys miss, and he has enough for a first down up past the 20. And Chris, wouldn't you say that right now, Alabama State, this score is where Alabama State would like it. Tuskegee would love to have it, you know, 30-30 by the end of the game, but it doesn't look like that's going to happen.
Yes, if Alabama State can keep this a low-scoring game and really contain Kevin Huff and that high-powered offense for Tuskegee, that would definitely be their preference. And you take a look at Jay Peck here. Look at that move. I remember when we watched him in the Gulf Coast Classic against Jackson State, what a phenomenal runner he was and how he caught our attention. We're seeing the same kind of moves today, a dependable running back and someone who I think maybe after year might have a shot to play at that next level.
Has gone over 1,000 yards on the season here today, and he gets a break. And his backup will come into the game. And that's number 6 right there. We are high up. Raymond Traylor is his backup, giving Jay Peck a little bit of a blow and a nice carry on first down. Bring up a 2nd down and 5. And Raymond Traylor is a guy that about the same size, but runs a little more north and south than Jay Peck does.
Yes, not as shifty, maybe not as much of those moves. Like you said, more straight ahead runner, but a nice balance for this Hornet backfield.
So a 2nd down and a manageable 5. Tuskegee is bringing the house. Ingram gets out of the pocket, and he gets up to the 34. He'll go out of bounds there, but Tuskegee was bringing a big blitz, and it got pushed to the middle, Chris, and Ingram was able to get to the outside.
And that's what Ingram has to continue to do. If there's nothing there, get outside the pocket, see if you can pick some up on the ground. If not, throw the ball away or eat it. That's what Coach Coe wants him to do, not to make the foolish penalties, but protect his team, and like we talked about earlier, protect the ball for this offense.
Earlier you mentioned the Gulf Coast Classic, and in that game, because Ingram wasn't playing all that well, we saw a lot of DeTepio Woods, and I thought maybe coming in today's game we would see Woods platooning a little bit more, but so far it's been Ingram and Ingram alone. Now a timeout on the field as Alabama State doesn't like what they see, and Charles Coe would rather spend a timeout, Chris, than have another one of those awful interceptions we saw just a few moments ago. But right now, while we have a second, let's take a look at the AFLAC trivia question. That duck. Which college football Hall of Famer played in 8 Turkey Day classics? Now, that's interesting. Played in 8. Now, I don't know when the rules changed and you're allowed to play 8 years of college football. So that's interesting. You're stumping me. Usually I'm on top of my game. Usually my preparation is, you know, impeccable. I don't know the answer to that one. We'll have the answer to the AFLAC trivia question a little bit later on during the ball game. And there you see the defensive backs of Alabama State talking it over. They've done a good job thus far at keeping Kevin Huff and that Tuskegee offense in check. They've only the one pass, Huff to Atkinson, the lone touchdown for Tuskegee. So we're back to play. First down for Alabama State and Alex Ingram. He has all kinds of time. He has a man wide open across the middle, and again throws an awful pass, and again it's intercepted. This time Justin Hanna makes the interception, and he had a man wide open and just threw it about 10 yards behind him.
Well, he really had 2 receivers open. Brandon Horace was open over the middle. James Craig was running deep, and that's where Alex Ingram has to get the ball off quicker. Right over the middle, got 2 receivers, 1 low, 1 high, and he throws his ball late and behind, and that's why it results in an interception. He gets that ball off a hair earlier with some more air towards the middle of the field. I think he's able to hit James Craig for a big touchdown, unfortunately behind, and that's where Ingram has to be more on time, and I guarantee you he's going to hear it from Coach Coe.
Well, I didn't want to be the bearer of bad tidings and make them put DeTepio Woods into the game, but after the last 2 interceptions, wow. Not good football from the quarterback position for Alabama State. So Kevin Huff will take over. And he's got a man wide open on the far side, one-on-one coverage, and wide open. The man who scored the touchdown a few moments ago, Jakari Atkinson, has been the man of the hour. Plenty of yards on that one for a first down into Alabama State territory.
And you see teams, when if they can take advantage of miscues and turnovers, that's going to help them in a ball game. I think this drive right here is where you see Tuskegee say, hey, you're going to give us the ball again. We're going to take full advantage. Every time you give us the ball in a turnover, we're going to take advantage of that. I think this is a drive where this really happens.
Well, there you see the turnover to Alabama State with three and two in the last few minutes, coming on interceptions by Alex Ingram. So now Huff, he's got a man in a nice throw and catch by Ashun Jackson, and a beautiful laser type pass by Kevin Huff.
And Kevin Huff knows, hey, if you're going to give me this ball, again, I'm going to take advantage. He's picking apart this defense right now, finding the holes and executing. You see him stand nice and tall in the pocket, got nice protection, and fires it in there in that hole to his receiver. You give a talented quarterback time like that and a defense where there's a lot of holes, he's going to exploit it every time.
That's why Kevin Huff is an all SIAC player. Now Kevin Huff finds a man to the near side and a nice open field tackle down there by Desmond Foster, but it is complete to Jason English. And again, it looks like Kevin Huff is getting in that rhythm, and there seems to be a receiver wide open on every single play.
He is, and it shows what a talented, what a smart quarterback he is, and what a leader he is. After sitting out the spring, he's really been trying to learn a new system, and talking to Coach Slater says he understands the system a little better, and I guarantee you when he leaves Tuskegee, the alumni, the fans, and the people that surround this program are gonna miss number four tremendously.
Tonight, timeout, as the play clock was getting down low. And so with 1:35 remaining here in the second quarter, Tuskegee looking to try and take the lead here before halftime. We'll take a break with them. It's a beautiful day in Montgomery, Alabama. And let's take a look at the
Aflac
trivia question. Which college football Hall of Famer played in 8 Turkey Day Classics? And the answer is...
Wow.
Ben Stevenson, 1923 to 1930. Here's the deal, folks. Back in the day, a long time ago, you could actually play if you were in high school. So Ben Stevenson was a starting running back for Tuskegee as a freshman through a senior in high school, and then, of course, played 4 years in college. That's how he played in 8 different Turkey Day classics. Flags down again. And it appeared that Alabama State was offsides again. So we'll see what the initial call is.
And I'm telling you, that Bama State defense really trying to get to Kevin Huff in a hurry, trying to anticipate that snap count, hasn't worked very well today. If I'm defensive coordinator Tony Pierce, I'm telling my guys, watch the ball, stop jumping off, because it's really not worth it with all of these penalties.
Let's take a look at the bands. They take this stuff serious, stretching,
oh yeah,
making sure we don't pull a hammy, getting set for the Church's Chicken Battle of the Bands coming up at halftime. You certainly do not want to miss that. But we've got a minute 20 to go before halftime. Before we get to that, Tuskegee is driving. Second down and short. Kevin Huff, he had a man open, decided to hold on to the ball. This time, smart play, just threw it away. He only needs about a half a yard for a first down, so a very smart play by number 4.
And that's what he's hearing from his coaches right there, JC. Good job. Way to throw the ball away. Don't risk a turnover, especially when we're approaching the red zone and only need a short distance for the first down. Could have come back inside late there and hit his receiver, but it's tough as a quarterback when you're rolling to the right, throwing across your body. And again, they don't want to risk a turnover right now. They'll live to play another down. Smart decision by the senior quarterback.
So now third down and short. 1:07. The clock is stopped after the incomplete pass.
Got that one-on-one coverage again, down below and up top.
And the whistle should have blown. They didn't, and I did. There you go. They're going to blow this one dead. The right tackle of Tuskegee moved way too early. It'll be a false start, and they'll move it back 5.
I think there's going to be a record set today for penalties, my friend.
Brother, I'm telling you what, wherever we go, the flags tend to follow. Yep, indeed, it's false start. We'll back it up 5. I almost think they bring extra flags out when they know that we're coming to town. So we'll back it up 5, and so now what was a would have been a first down, now will be a third down and 6.
Alabama State band getting that prayer in, always good.
I tell you what, it is entertaining. Not only watch them when they get on the field, but the preparation.
And now they're breakdancing.
Well, I told you, they're old school and new school.
Getting the arms loose. Get it loose.
Everybody prepares differently. Getting the game face on. Mm-hmm. Getting spiritually ready. You know, I love the battle of the bands. It's one of the best things about coming to an HBCU football game. So now third down and six. 103 remaining. Kevin Huff. He's got a man wide open over the middle. Eludes one tackler, but it's going to be taken down at the 18. But it will be enough for a first down. Jason English is on the catch. And the clock will stop as the chains will move. And right now, while we have a quick second, an Xbox Live big play replay from the second quarter. And I tell you what, the big-time interception by Michael Cope.
I'm telling you, what a big play by Michael Cope, breaking on the route. It looked wide open, but his closing speed, able to pick off Kevin Huff, gave Alabama State good field position and a big break for that Hornet defense.
But since that interception, Tuskegee has had two of their own, and that allows Tuskegee to be inside the red zone yet again. So now Kevin Huff throws it to the outside, and that is complete. But really, for no gain, Lorenzo Crawford saying, yeah, it's a catch, but it's probably better off that it's not. And if Crawford saw where he caught it at, it's going to save them some time. And really, he didn't have any gain on the play anyway.
Well, the officials, it's tough to see from some of the angles. We saw a possible missed call earlier on the ball that hit the ground. Looked like that one might have touched the ground as well. But with no review and no replay, they've got to go off really what they see with their own eyes.
So the Golden Tigers will take another timeout with 24 seconds remaining in the second quarter to discuss things and see if they can't get on the board here before halftime.
Number three is the back. I mean, if he lines up and empty, all right, we got dime on the field. So we're going to go spy, combo. Now, look like you're a man, press up safeties, corners, and then back out. Outside backers, you got number two. All right, if he goes out and up. Safeties play the post.
There you see discussing the defensive side of the ball and what they're going to do. I love hearing stuff like that. Like hearing the coaches get in there and talk about what they're going to do. Head man Charles Cope. So now we're back to action. Second down and nine for Tuskegee and Kevin Huff. Huff back to pass. He's got a man coming over the middle. That's English again inside the 10. And he's going to be marked out at the 8. And so that'll be first down and goal for Tuskegee. 16 seconds to go. And certainly, maybe the score's not what we expected, but it's been all about the flags and the turnovers here today in this Turkey Day Classic, Chris.
Well, definitely. That's one thing both teams have to eliminate is the penalties. They have to take advantage when the other team has the penalties, but they've got to clean up their games and execute. We've seen a lot of points and yards left on the field because of all the big penalties.
And don't forget, everybody, coming up halftime, Church's Chicken Battle of the Bands. I'm getting stretched out, too. I'm getting ready. As they're getting ready back on the field, first down and goal, 16 seconds. And they'd love to punch it in right here before halftime. So now Kevin Huff, fake to the man. He's got a man wide open, and that one just too low. It was intended out there for his running back coming out of the backfield, so Jocelyn Finley, and it would have been a touchdown, but just not enough juice by Kevin Huff.
And that's where Huff has to step to his target. You see his mechanics fail him here a little bit, tries to use all arm and not able to get the ball in the flat to his fullback Finley. That would have been a walk-in touchdown for number 32.
So now second down and goal, 12 seconds are on the clock. And Tuskegee, they've done all this in the last couple of minutes, trying to punch it in and take a lead heading into halftime. So four wide receivers. One back in the backfield.
One-on-one coverage down below.
Huff, he's got a man open, and that one fired too low, intended for Ashun Jackson, and good coverage on the play by number four, Jimmy Toussaint.
I'm surprised to see we saw the one-on-one coverage to go in there and run a slant with all that other traffic, not run an out route or even a fade route. There's no one back there. They've hit it earlier, so I'm surprised to see the call from Coach Slater and going with that slant route. We'll see what they come back here, see if they can take advantage of that one-on-one coverage.
So now third down and goal. 7 seconds are on the clock before halftime. The Alabama State defense trying to make a stand. right before halftime. Kevin Huff, the fade, and just overshoots, and his wide receiver got tangled up with a couple of defenders, and Jason English was unable to get out there, and the pass was pretty good, but English just got tied up.
And that's the play we talked about, going to that fade route, but like you said, JC, English gets tied up when you try to run that pick with the two receivers. A lot of traffic in there, not able to get that free release to the outside. If he was, I think it would have been a touchdown.
So now Tuskegee will try for a field goal. Roosevelt Echeverry. Long on the year, 40. There you see 10 for 15 on the season. A quality kicker with a very strong leg. Be a 25-yard attempt. Echeverry, the kick is up. And the kick curls back in. So with no time left on the clock, Echeverry and Tuskegee are able to take a 3-point lead into halftime. Echeverry, a young man who has overcome some adversity in his life to come back and kick for Tuskegee. At one point, got shot in the leg and now is back to 100%. And there you can see, probably realizing a dream, kicking a field goal here in the Turkey Day Classic here this afternoon. There you see the big crowd on hand. Always a full capacity crowd of well over 22,000 for this game each and every year. But Chris, Tuskegee down 7 early on, and they were able to come back and score 10 late in the first half.
Well, they were finally able to eliminate some of the penalties, and we've got a ball game here at halftime. The thing I'm looking forward to is coming out seeing a cleaner second half and more offensive showmanship here in the second half.
And right now, Coach Slater from Tuskegee is joining us. Coach Slater, you were down 7, but what were you able to do to come back in late in that first half, sir?
Well, we've been killing ourselves. I thought we moved the ball well on them the whole game. We just make mistakes, get penalties, even turn the ball over. And we didn't turn the ball over, and we were able to get the ball in the end zone.
Coach, what can you say about your defense, the kind of pressure they're putting on Alex Ingram? They're playing well. What adjustments do you think you need to make offensively to be more efficient and cut out the penalties?
Well, I mean, they're forcing us to throw the ball. They're blitzing just about every down and bringing more guys in the box than we can handle, so they're forcing us to throw the ball. We just got to make sure we adjust some of our routes. And then we got to try to establish some kind of running game, I think, second half in order to keep our defense off the field.
All right, Coach Slater, we appreciate it. Get into the locker room and get your team ready.
Thank you.
All right, you got it. Well, I tell you what, Tuskegee and Alabama State, competitive as always, as we head to the Church's Chicken Battle of the Bands. Tuskegee takes a 10-7 lead into the half. Welcome back to halftime. Tuskegee leads at 10-7. It is now time for the Church's Chicken Battle of the Band. Up first, the Tuskegee Marching Crimson Pipers. Enjoy, everybody. We'll be right back. The Tuskegee Marching Crimson Pipers. We'll take a quick break when we come back. The Mighty Marching Hornets. It's a battle of the bands, everybody. Back at halftime in Montgomery, Alabama, the Church's Chicken Battle of the Bands continues. The Mighty Marching Hornets from Alabama State, everybody.
TV.
We're back at halftime. Tuskegee leads Alabama State 10-7 in the 83rd annual Turkey Day Classic alongside Chris Ricks. I am Jonathan Coachman, and Chris, this game started off turnovers, and a lot of penalties. Let's go take a look at some of the first half highlights, and you'll see a lot of what I was just talking about.
Yes, very sloppy out of the gate for both teams. Interception there from Huff. He should have just thrown it away or eaten it, and then we see Ingram coming back here, throwing the interception late. Again, very sloppy for both teams. Not very polished out of the gate here. Teams taking advantage of those turnovers. If that happens, expect that to happen more in the second half as far as taking advantage. But teams have to clean it up. And the penalties, couldn't say enough about the penalties from both teams. probably one of the longest first halves we've had because of all the penalties. I guarantee you, Coach Coe and Coach Slater in the locker room emphasizing to their teams, let's clean it up, fellas.
Yeah, at halftime at 10-7, a couple of late first half touchdowns got us to the score we have right now. And Chris, Tuskegee and Alabama State are going to have to do a lot offensively to get things going to alleviate the penalties and turnovers.
Yes, well, the first thing they have to do is just that, clean it up. Stop the offsides penalties, stop the false starts, clean up their games and execute, and expect a lot cleaner second half.
Well, we're just getting set. A few minutes left here in the halftime. Of course, the Battle of the Bands continues, and we're excited. Turkey Day Classic here in Montgomery, Alabama. We'll get set for the second half when we come back.
It started with 10 teams, one dream, and one ring. Now we're down to the final two. The 2006 SWAC Championship game, the University of Arkansas Pine Bluff will face off against Alabama A&M University. It's a rematch as Alabama A&M looks for revenge against the Pine Bluff Golden Lions, this time for the ring. Saturday, December 16, kickoff 1 p.m. at Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama. Tickets on sale now. Call 1-800-277-1700. Find out who will be the 2006 SWAC champion.
HBCU football presented by the U.S. Navy, Tuskegee and Alabama State is being brought to you by Church's Ticket. Come on, get spicy. And by HBCU Connect, HBCUConnect.com, the online home for black college sports. And by Buy HBCU. Log on to www.buyhbcu.com for exclusive HBCU merchandise. We're back at halftime. Don't forget to cast your vote in the Church's Chicken HBCU Battle of the Bands. Log on to www.cstv.com/HBCU to vote. The school with the most votes will receive a donation from Church's Chicken. Show your support by voting now at cstv.com/HBCU. Alongside Chris Rich, Jonathan Coachman, just about set for the second half. And Chris, we need to take a look at your Nissan ship performance.
Well, first of all, for ASU, you've got to continue to pressure Huff. You've got to continue to put that pressure on him, maybe force him into some more bad decisions. On defense, you've got to clean it up, eliminate the penalties. And as far as Tuskegee, you've got to establish a running game, take some of that pressure off of Kevin Huff. And for them, they've got to clean it up on offense. The penalties are hurting them. So both of these teams, as we've talked about, have to have a much cleaner second half, JC.
That is your Nissan shift performance. And the Alabama State band and Tuskegee band work their way back into the stands to settle in for the second half. A second half that looks to be, it's going to be very tight throughout. Of course, last year, remember, final in overtime, 28-27, Tuskegee coming out on top. Alabama State tried to get some revenge this year in the Turkey Day Classic, the 83rd annual. So we are all set for the second half kickoff. Desmond Foster is back to receive for Alabama State. And Roosevelt Echeverry, who put his team on top at the end of the first half, is set for the second half kickoff for Tuskegee. So a high end over end kick comes down to Foster at the 9. He fumbles it, picks it right back up. And he will get out past the 25 at a hard running return. And Desmond Foster will give his team pretty good field position, and Alex Ingram, who had a couple of bad mistakes late in the first half, will come back onto the field.
And I guarantee you that offensive coordinator, head coach Coe, talked to Ingram at the half, telling him to forget the first half, eliminate those plays, let's play a smarter second half, get the ball to your playmakers, and protect the ball for our offense.
Those 10 points late for Tuskegee came off of two Alex Ingram interceptions. So now first down and 10, ball marked at the 30 of the Hornets. Ingram from that familiar shotgun formation. J-Peck had a hole, had a lot of space, slipped down on the turf, and instead of maybe a 7 or 8 yard run, only picked up about 3.
And we talk about those mistakes that Ingram made in the first half. That's why we're seeing at the beginning here of the second half, giving the ball to J-Peck, letting Ingram get comfortable here in this second half here and not put him in a position where he's going to make any big mistakes.
Tachepio Woods is the backup for Alabama State. We have not seen him to this point here today. He normally does get a few carries or a few plays each game, regardless of how Ingram is playing. So now Ingram hands off to the second back through. The first time we've called this guy's number, number 47, Jeremy Miles, is in there for Alabama State, and he gets taken down. And take a look right now, Tuskegee, the defense moving very, very well.
Well, Tuskegee defensive line did a nice job adjusting at the half, and defensive coordinator Reginald Ruffin getting them squared. You see those techniques, a little shift techniques, trying to shut down that running game in Jay Peck.
Ever since the Jay Peck touchdown in the first half, Alabama State has been unable to get any more points on the board. Now they face a big third down and long. Ingram rolling to the near side. He's got a man wide open, and a nice pitch and catch complete out there to number 13, James Craig. And that'll be good for an Alabama State first down.
And I think that's what you have to continue to do, Coach Coe, offensive coordinator, is continue to get Ingram outside the pocket. He seems more comfortable when he's throwing on the run, and he has the option to maybe keep it and run it himself if there's nothing there. We've seen when he stays in that pocket, that's where he's had the bad decisions, forcing balls in there, and with the pressure from the Tuskegee defensive line, not able to step into all of his throws.
Ball right at midfield now for Alabama State. Ingram from the shotgun again. He will keep it this time. And a nice mixed direction, pitches back to Craig, and a nice open field tackle down there on the near side by number 27. That is Jared Simpson, who kept Craig from getting more than the 4 yards he had already got.
And that's where a block is definitely going to help out the receiver on this. We see the option right here, run. That's really going to help Cray out if he can pick up a block. Instead, he catches the ball, has Simpson right in his face, and there's not much he can do.
Here early in this first drive of the second half, you can see some of the adjustments that the Alabama State offense has been able to make against a speedy Tuskegee defense. Now Tuskegee bringing the corner blitz. Jay Peck runs right past it and gets about 4 yards. That'll bring up a third down and short for the Hornets offense.
Tuskegee continuing to bring that pressure off the edge. I know JC looked like a corner blitz. Actually, the safety came down, came off the edge, but they call a nice play and getting the running play by that pursuit. Not a big game, but negate that blitz off the edge. And Jay Peck just trying to get what he can with all that pressure in his face.
Yeah, number 20 has shown some great field vision here today. And when it looks like he doesn't have any yards to gain, he certainly gets at least two or three. So yep. Now third down and two or three. And we'll go to the second back crew, and nowhere that time to go. Stacked up at the line of scrimmage. And once the pile comes out of it, on the carry was Raymond Traylor, the backup to Jay Peck. They get no gain. And on fourth down and two, Alabama State appears like they're going to punt. So Anthony Johnson is in for to punt, but Tuskegee, a big third down stop.
Yes, and they've really come out of the locker room. They stepped up, stopping the first drive for this Hornet offense, able to get the ball back. This defense, look for them to continue to step up throughout this second half.
Johnson, high kick. It's going to come down at the 10. Ashun Jackson lets it roll, and the ball is going to go into the end zone. Three or four different Alabama State cover guys were there to cover it inside the five. They hit each other, and the ball goes into the end zone for a touchback. So Tuskegee will get the ball for the first time here in the second half. And they are nursing a very scant 3-point lead. Alabama State stopped on their first possession, so now Tuskegee, the Golden Tigers, and Kevin Huff will get their first chance here in the second half. Turkey Day Classic, Montgomery, Alabama. We are live at the Crampton Bowl. What a fantastic, beautiful day for football this has turned out to be. Kevin Huff will take the first snap from the shotgun and show that speed, and he gets pushed out of bounds on the far sideline, but not before picking up 14, maybe 15 yards in a first down.
And I'm telling you, coming out in the second half, if there's someone that is going to keep Tuskegee with this lead and enable them to put more points on the board, it's going to be the senior quarterback in Kevin Huff. You see right here, just a quarterback draw, or recon as we used to call it at Florida State. That's a drawn play. That's not his decision to keep it. Catch the ball, hold the linebackers for a second, and then gets what you can. A nice run, picking up a first down for the Tuskegee offense.
And you saw a shot there, Coach Willie Slater. He's really been a joy to work with the entire week in his first Turkey Day Classic. Very excited about the fact that he gets to work on Thanksgiving Day, as we all do, and very excited to be here. Riley, the running back, Finley, for Tuskegee, a short gain on first down, bring him a second down and long. And you're really seeing here that Tuskegee in the first half, Chris, and probably in the second half, really likes to spread out this Alabama State defense so they can open up the lanes for a Kevin Huff. We'll probably see more of the same here in the second half.
They do. I think Coach Slater, who's also the offensive coordinator, has done a good job spreading it out with the formations. And in the play calling, if they can just clean up those penalties, eliminate those penalties, we're going to see a very exciting second half from this offense.
I'd love to see no penalties in the second half. Now, Huff is pressured and had to release it a little bit early, and it was intended out there for Lorenzo Crawford, but he was getting hounded in the pocket and had to throw it just a little bit too early and too high, too.
Well, he tried to force the ball to Crawford. He had Richard Fitzhugh, his back, right on the flat right here, tries to throw it over the defensive back, has to elevate that ball, and that's why it's too high. I guarantee you, if Huff could have had that back, he would have reset and dumped it off to his back, Fitzhugh, who was wide open in the flat.
So now third down and 9 for Tuskegee. Alabama State looking for a big stop here early in the second half. We were under 10 minutes play in the third quarter. Tuskegee leads by 3. Huff from the shotgun has plenty of time. Just hurried the throw a little bit. It was intended for a Shun Jackson. Thrown behind him, incomplete, fourth down.
And we talk about mechanics. You see the frustration there on the part of Kevin Huff. He's got to settle down, just relax, be confident in his ability, and step towards his target. He's stepping a little away from his targets right now and relying on his arm, and he has a very strong arm, but because of mechanics failed right now, it's throwing off his accuracy.
Frustration's a great word. I think that's a little understated. He does not look happy at all out there, Kevin Huff on the far sideline. So now the unusual punt formation.
But a usual penalty.
You got that right. I don't know if I've ever seen a team punt from about 7 yards behind the line of scrimmage. You're asking for a punt to be blocked.
Yep.
So we'll get this one sorted out and see what the call is. So a false start. Back it up 5. And Tuskegee will try fourth down again.
And I thought it might have been encroachment or offsides on the Alabama State defense or block team right there, but it looks like the ball was moved and that caused them to jump offsides, a penalty for Tuskegee.
Michael Cope, who had the big interception in the first half for Alabama State, the coach's son, is back to return. And the punt comes down to Cope at the 32, and he's got room to run. Cope, misdirection, he's got some quick feet, boy. He's up to the 45, and he'll be dragged down there. But a nice return by number 19. And so Alabama State will have very good field position at their own 45. But that's good field position. When we come back, we gotta take a break. Tuskegee remains up by 3. It's all about family. It's all about Thanksgiving. Happy birthday, Zach.
Buddy.
We're getting it all in.
Hey, buddy.
I tell you what, everybody out here, certainly appreciate you working on Thanksgiving as the CSTV crew brings you the 83rd Turkey Day Classic. Zach, hopefully you're having a happy birthday and a happy Thanksgiving.
Did you see that hat? Nice hat.
I like that, yeah.
It's homemade.
Good picture, too. Cute kid. All right, first down and 10. Alabama State takes over. Alex Ingram will try to get his offense back on track. He hands it off to number 20, Jay Peck. Tuskegee has his number. Short gain on the play, bring up a second down. You know, we talked about the pick number 33, the stud defensive back four, Chris Dupuy for Alabama State, taping him up, fixing the toes. What are they doing there, Chris?
Well, it's got to be blisters. I remember when I'd get those kind of tape jobs, he's got to have some blisters on his big toe there, and that makes it very uncomfortable with this type of surface, a lot of friction in those cleats. Hopefully it won't keep him out of the ball game for ASU.
And I'm sure Dupuy's family loves the fact that we're showing his feet on camera. If there's nothing else you can show his feet getting taped up in his toes. Peck again gets the call. He'll take it straight up the middle, just shy of midfield, and he'll bring up a third down as the third quarter moves along. Clock moving, 8:30 and counting. Here on Thanksgiving, Alabama State trails in the Turkey Day Classic 10-7 to the Golden Tigers from Tuskegee. So now third down, 4 wideouts for Alabama State and Alex Ingram. Ingram back to pass, getting pressured, and he's gonna go down. 3, 4, 5 Tuskegee defenders led that time by number 59, Brandon Anderson. Ingram had no time to find a receiver. He goes down. Alabama State has to punt.
And you have to credit Ingram's heart right there, trying to stay up when he's got two, three defenders on him. He's got to realize there's nothing there. Go down. He cannot risk an injury. It's been tough for him to get through this season because of his injuries. That's why they've had to turn to Chepio Woods. He's got to stay healthy for this ball club if he wants to finish his game.
So now Alabama State will punt. And Jackson is back again for the return. And the kick comes down to Jackson. It's a nice catch of the 19, the fair catch. And that's where Tuskegee will take over. Well, folks, don't forget, log on to HBCUConnect.com. It's the official online home for black college sports. And we've had some really good HBCU games this year, Chris.
Oh, yeah.
This will be our last one of the season. And I'm certainly proud to be here. We've had Alabama State a couple of times. Lane College,
Morehouse,
Albany State. We've been around the Southern globe to bring HBCU football to you right here on CSTV. So now back to action. Tuskegee takes over at their own 19. And Kevin Huff, English in motion. He'll hand off to Finley, the first back through, and no room to go. He's upended for no gain by number 33 with the take toe, Chris Dupuy.
And there we see the run to Finley, a very minimal gain there. Expect Coach Slater to go back to the passing game. We saw the frustration at the end of the last drive in Kevin Huff. And I'm telling you, as a quarterback, when you're frustrated like that, you start getting the emotion high. You want to get out there, start throwing the ball. Expect number four to get in a groove on this drive.
Well, you already called the touchdown earlier in the game. So you certainly belong on the Crystal Ball Show this week. So we'll see if your second call of the day will be as good. Kevin Huff pressured again. He's outside the pocket, and this time he's going to throw it into the second row. It is complete, but it's to Mother Johnson up there, and she makes the catch, throws the ball back onto the field, third down.
And I'm telling you, frustration, especially on that play for Kevin Huff. He had Jakari Atkinson wide open up top on a one-on-one coverage, but as soon as he comes out of his play action, there's pressure right in his face, causes him to get outside of the pocket, try by a little more time. By that time, the coverage had recovered and shut down Atkinson. I guarantee you, if he'd had one more second to get that ball off, it would have been touchdown Tuskegee.
So now another big third down play, Chris, and it seems like here in the second half, we're about 9 minutes deep. It's been three and out. Neither one of these offenses have been able to get going. So now a blitz by Alabama State and a beautiful catch. The ball was behind the intended receiver. Lorenzo Crawford will see where they mark the ball at. And it's going to be all about the mark right at the marker. And they say it is good, just good, for a first down.
And that's a nice job by Kevin Huff. If you talk to a quarterback, you want to have the ball there as your receiver comes out of the break, especially with the pressure. Has to have the ball waiting there for his receiver. But with the pressure, it forces his accuracy to be a little off. A nice job by Crawford getting around, even though the ball's thrown to the outside where it should be, a little bit outside of his range, but he's able to pull it in and pick up the first down.
Yeah, great hands, great concentration,
come on,
a great first down. And he pitched back to Fitzhugh, and the ball is out. The ball is on the ground, and it appears like Alabama State has recovered. And they have. Richard Fitzhugh. It didn't appear like he got hit all that hard. The ball came out, and Alabama State gets another turnover inside Tuskegee territory.
And that's why you'll hear running back coaches telling their running back, no daylight in the cavity. A lack of ball security right there from Fitzhugh. And I know you want to try to establish the running game if you're Coach Slater, but I don't know why you don't stick with Kevin Huff. The passing game has been working very well. They go to the run game here, and you see the hit, the helmet right on the ball. And if you're a football coach, you teach your defenders, put a helmet on the ball. That'll force it to come out more times than not. And you see there Fitzhugh putting it on the ground. Big break for Bama State.
The recovery by number 29, Lael Harrison. The hit by number 33, Chris Dupuy. That combination gives Alabama State the ball back. Jay Peck gets the call inside the 35, and now Alabama State will try to hurry this thing up and maybe get a quick punch to the face of Tuskegee.
And they need that. They need to get back in this ball game. I believe if Tuskegee gets the ball back, they're going to put another 7 on the board. And if you're an ASU fan, you don't want to get behind anymore.
No.
They've got to take advantage of this great field position, protect the ball, control it, and get at least 3 on the board and tie up this ball game.
And you got to love the fact when we profile certain players coming into the games and they come out and perform, that's exactly what Chris Dupuy has done. He's been very big on the defensive side of the ball for Alabama State. So now 2nd down and 6 for Alex Ingram, I formation. He's looking to pass. He's got a man open. It's completed to Cray, who had a one-on-one coverage. Cray fights his way inside the 25, down to about the 23. Good for a first down. The chains will move.
And that's what you have to do. Coach Cole, offensive coordinator, give your quarterback chances to succeed. Keep it simple on the outside. Nice little hitch route out there. And that's what you have to do with Ingram. Some of the mistakes have been when you've asked him to do too much. Go through a big read, and especially with the time, he's not getting a lot of time with the pressure from that Golden Tiger defensive line. Get the ball out of his hands quickly to his playmakers where they can make something happen.
And speaking of time, Chris, the third quarter has moved along very quickly. And we are approaching 4 minutes as the clock has stopped currently. 4 wide receivers. Tuskegee looking to blitz. And they catch Jake Peck from the outside. Good pursuit from the outside by the Golden Tigers. And no gain on the play. Maybe a little half a yard, maybe, for Jake Peck. And they have really done a great job and really a good game plan, Chris, of focusing on Jake Peck and making Alex Ingram beat them through the air.
Well, exactly, and that's why when they bring that extra defender in the box and bring another linebacker on the line of scrimmage, you've got to have someone to pick him up. Again, Tuskegee really keying on that run game, forcing Ingram to beat them, but Alabama State not having that extra lineman to take off that blitz.
Aflac is the proud sponsor of the 1st and 10 line for today's game. Ingram, he had a man open, but he got hit. A flag is down. Ingram is down, and we'll have to sort this one out. He had a man that broke open, number 10, Lorenzo Hoffman, was out there, and Ingram just got lit up.
And you can see him right there. He feels it. Ingram bending over, and Kareem Anderson, number 99, defensive tackle for Tuskegee, laid the wood, as you would say, JC, on Ingram. Surprised not to see a penalty there. Kind of pulled that jump shot that you see a lot of college players and a lot of pro players do now. That can be viewed as taunting. Surprised not to see a penalty on that after the play.
Well, indeed, there was no penalty called on that play, but there was a penalty called on Alabama State, ineligible man downfield, so they will move it back 5, but you're right, Chris, they could have had a penalty on the play on the quarterback. They didn't, so that'll bring up a 2nd down as we move it back 5, and Alabama State, when you look at the points to penalties, I mean, it is really incredible. 17 penalties.
Wow.
17 total points. Hence the frustration in my voice. Can you hear? 2nd down, long for the Hornets. Ingram, shotgun, hands off to Peck straight up the middle. He gets hit by number 28, Albert Booker Jr. We've called his name a couple of times today. Short gain on the play, and I'm bringing up a 3rd down, and this is not where Coach Coy wants his quarterback to be.
Yeah, surprising the play call to go to the running game in Jay Peck on 2nd and long. Now it's going to be 3rd and about 12 or 13. Expect Alabama State to go back to the air now with Alex Ingram. The only thing is, if we know it, JC, the Tuskegee defense knows that as well, and defensive coordinator Reginald Ruffin is going to be in a coverage to shut down that passing game.
And Ingram has been prone to the interception here today. So now shotgun again. He's going to roll out to the far side, getting pressure. He's got a man in the end zone and overthrown and out of the end zone. He had a man open for a minute and just too much on the throw. And that one will be incomplete. 4th down, and now Alabama State will attempt the game-tying field goal.
And a little late there on Ingram when he's outside the pocket. You'd like to make that throw a little sooner. When you start getting towards the boundary, that defense starts to recover. And those holes that were there, those receivers that were open, just are not open anymore. You see, he would have liked to have thrown it right there, but because of the pressure, has to go more towards the boundary. By the time he throws that ball, it's out of the back of the end zone. And you saw Alex Ingram picking himself up again off that turf.
43-yard field goal attempt. Anthony Johnson. The kick is up, and the kick is curling. Nice
nicely right back through. So Anthony Johnson from 43 yards out, and we have a tie ball game, everybody. We're going to take a break. We were under 3 minutes to play here in the third. It's a barn burner, as they say. We are tied at 10. The Alabama State band on their best behavior here this afternoon. Anthony Johnson, just a moment ago, a 43-yard game-tying field goal. We're all tied up at 10 here in Montgomery at the 83rd annual Turkey Day Classic. And Tuskegee now will get the ball back and look to see if they can respond to that last field goal. And as Chris Ricks finishes off his cookie, we're all set for the kickoff. Ball comes down to Ashton Jackson. And after the initial confusion, Jackson has all kinds of room. And he's up past the 30. And the ball came out, but they're going to say that he was down by contact. And Tuskegee will retain possession.
Did you say Action Jackson, JC?
Well, yeah, I was just trying to throw off. It's actually Ashton, but I said Action. Just trying to have some fun. But they almost had a big-time cross-up here on the kickoff. Almost went down.
Yeah, big break for Tuskegee that one of them did not go down. Obviously, they would be pinned deep in their own territory, but a nice job by Jackson hitting the hole. Had about one, maybe two guys to beat on that. Lucky for Alabama State, they recover and not let that one get away.
So now Kevin Huff, who is showing a lot of frustration on the sidelines in this third quarter, will have to figure out a way to get back on the right track. And again, Alabama State brings five. Huff flushed out of the pocket again. And he is pushed out of the 35, maybe a little bit late. But the defense again responding to the challenge. And speaking of defense responding, what about the Xbox Live big play replay of this third quarter? And it's the fumble by Richard Fitchu.
Well, Bama State coming up big, and it shows that even mechanical engineering majors fumble the ball there. You see in Fitzhugh the lack of ball security, giving him the ball over to the Hornets and allowing them to tie the ball game.
So now second down and 9 for the Golden Tigers. There you see the turnovers here today, 3 apiece by each team. And again, Huff is pressured, and again, he throws behind his intended receiver, Jakari Atkinson. And so Kevin Huff, we were singing his praises in the first half, Chris, and how accurate he is and how strong of an arm he has. And here in the third quarter, Alabama State is bringing a couple extra guys, and that's really throwing Kevin Huff off his game.
And that's exactly it. Tony Pierce, defensive coordinator for Bama State, doing a great job applying the pressure to Kevin Huff, now allowing him to sit in that pocket, go through his reads, and be the playmaker that he is. They've got him out of his rhythm. He's kind of rattled, and that's causing him to play erratic, and it's sacrificing his accuracy right now. Because of that pressure, he's not able to step into his passes and get the ball to his receivers.
Play clock is down to 4, 3, 2. And now the frustration continues to mount for Tuskegee. Kevin Huff has to call a timeout. And here, as we head towards the late part of this game, those timeouts are going to become so important to have in your back pocket. And we talk about Kevin Huff. Let's take a look at some of the pressures that we're talking about with the Tuskegee headman.
And you talk about the senior quarterback. When I talk to Coach Slater, he says, some guys talk the talk. Kevin Huff walks the walk. And we've seen him today make plays, but he hasn't been able to be his normal self because of all that pressure that Bama State is bringing on him. He can't sit there, go through his reads. You see some passes. He's even having a tough time getting it out to his receivers. They've caught a couple breaks, but the pressure, again, has been the difference in Kevin Huff not being able to play his game.
There you see that last play was the lone positive play. Here in this game for Tuskegee, the touchdown pass to Jakari Atkinson. But since then, really nothing to speak about as far as the Tuskegee offense is concerned. So now, coming out of the timeout, we've got a third down and 9 for the Golden Tigers. Alabama State looking again to force Tuskegee 3 and out and get the ball back. So now shotgun for Huff. Back to pass. Steps up in the pocket. He's got a man on the far side, and it's complete. And it looks to be enough for a first down, and it is complete to Jason English.
And Kevin Huff did a great job of buying himself some time, getting out of the pocket and completing the pass.
Yes, and we see Huff getting up a little slowly. Might have taken a shot there, and he does a nice job, like you said, JC, stepping up. I like how he took what the defense gave him on that play. Alabama State is going to play everyone deep and test the patience of the senior quarterback. They don't want to give up that home run ball. Huff is going to have to continue to take the short routes and take what that defense gives him.
Chains move, first down, 46-yard line. I formation. Maybe the first time all day we've seen only one wide receiver for Kevin Huff. He's going to hand it off to the first man through. That's Finley. And Finley, no place to go, stacked up at the line of scrimmage, second down.
Tuskegee just trying to keep this defense honest. They know they're going to get it done through the air in the passing game, but trying to mix it up a little bit, give it up the middle with Fitzhugh, give the ball to Finley, and try to suck some of those linebackers up so they can hit those routes behind that second level of defense.
Clock continues to run. We're under a minute and a half to go here in this third quarter. Second down and 10 for Kevin Huff and the Golden Tigers. Four wide receivers, that's more like it. And he's got a man breaking open, and again he had his man open, Jakari Atkinson, and again Kevin Huff hurries the throw, throws behind Atkinson.
Well, unfortunately for Tuskegee, Huff has to rush this ball because, again, of that pressure. There's a lot of pressure in his face. He's not able to step into that pass, and we'll take a look at it right here. Takes one step back. He's even in the shotgun, but right there, pressure coming off the backside. Even though it's not in front of him, he feels that coming off the backside, and it forced him to rush that pass and sacrifice his accuracy on that ball.
And the frustration seems to be seeping out to the head man, Willie Slater, as well.
Yep.
Not as many smiles as we had in the first half on that TU sideline. So now third down, 10, four wide receivers, four Huff. Plenty of time again, he's got a man open on the far sideline and just a little bit too far, and it was intended for English. Kevin Huff just put too much juice on the ball, fourth down, punting opportunity.
And I'm surprised to see Alabama State go back to that coverage. They've been playing with the two safeties and keeping everything in front of them. I thought the biggest mistake they can make is either go back to that cover four man coverage or a single safety. At least on this one, they have a safety helping over the top. That's why Huff has to flatten out the ball. He couldn't put as much air on this pass as he wanted, and that results in an overthrow.
Michael Coe, the coach's son, back to return the punt. The quick kick. And the punt comes down in a perfect hop to toe. And he's got a lot of room straight up the middle. And he's going to take it all the way back up to the 30. So a nice return, nearly 20 yards on the return for Michael Coe. Well, folks, what better way to recover from your Thanksgiving feast than with some heated hoops battles? Tune in tomorrow, starting at noon, for action from the South Padre Island Invitational, featuring ninth-ranked Wisconsin versus Missouri State and Oklahoma State versus Auburn. Then at 5, we head to Ohio to give you an early glimpse at Rick Pitino's Louisville squad as they take on Dayton. It's a full day of college basketball. Where else? Right here, only CSTV. As I mentioned, I'm flying to Cincinnati tonight. I'll be there. See Rick Pitino. High five, my main man. Should be a good battle tomorrow night. All three games here on CSTV.
Pitino, Petrino, they're all there.
They're all there, baby. Alex Ingram. Oh, he gets rocked from behind. And he's going to lose 3, maybe 4 yards on the play. And really, that one was busted up from the beginning. And that will probably be the last play of this third quarter.
And that's what we've talked about. I'm surprised in the play call by Coach Coe, leaving Alex Ingram in that pocket. We see all the pressure coming from this Tuskegee defensive line and the linebackers. He doesn't have any time to go through his reads. I think you've got to continue to get the ball out of his hands quickly. And we see him limping off the field right there. He is taking some shots. You've got to get the ball out of his hands quicker.
Well, you only got to make it through one more quarter. This is exactly the way that we would have liked it. Heading into the fourth, all tied up at 10. Who's got the most to get it done? Tuskegee, Alabama State. We'll find out who wants to suck it up when the start of the fourth. When we come back. You bet it's time for the fourth quarter. We're all set. Alabama State, Tuskegee, we're all tied up at 10. Chris Ricks, Jonathan Coachman, our entire CSTV crew. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody. And settle in for the fourth quarter. It should be a good one. Second down and long for Alabama State and Alex Ingram. Four wideouts. to this point, only a field goal here in the second half, and the handoff to Raymond Traylor. And Traylor picks up a few, but that'll bring up a third down and long, a situation that both teams have been in quite a bit here in the second half.
Well, that run gets the Hornets back to the original line of scrimmage. Now third and about 10, just a little under 10. Expect Ingram to go back to the air now. He's got to sit in there, be composed, and find his receivers, try to find those holes in this Tuskegee defense.
Ingram in the shotgun. Back to pass, not much of a rush on Ingram, but he's going to pull it down, and he's going to be taken down and just mashed. Big number 99, Kareem Anderson, 6 feet, 294. He's a junior, and he blasted Ingram. And really, Chris, you tell me if I'm wrong, but he really didn't wait for the play to develop, came back, and then sprinted out of the pocket.
Well, I think that pressure is really starting to get to Alex Ingram now. Like you said, JC, probably bailed out of that pocket a little early, and we see him going outside. Coach Bowen always used to tell me, try to step up vertical in the pocket, and we see here with Alex Ingram, rather than stepping up and working up in the pocket, tries to get outside, and when you've got defensive linemen as fast as Tuskegee's, you're not going to get outside very often, and I know Coach Coe wants his quarterback to sit in there, step up, and try to get vertical. If nothing's there, make something happen with his feet.
Jared Simpson is the man down on the field for Tuskegee. While we have a second, folks, buy HBCU.com. Log on to www.buyhbcu.com for exclusive HBCU merchandise. A lot of good stuff there. That's where I get all mine. All right, I'm lying. They give me a lot of free stuff, but I'll take it.
We take a look at Simpson there going off the field. He's had a big day causing that fumble. And talking to Coach Slater this week, he says, Chris, we could very easily be 10-0. It's the injuries that have hurt us this year. Have had guys out for a few games, some even more than that. And Coach Slater believes that's what's held this team back. Without that, they could very easily, in his opinion, be undefeated.
Simpson is up and helped off the field. And we are back to action. So third down and about 6. Ingram rolls to his right, trying to buy himself some time. He has a man over the middle, and this time it is complete. Completed to number 17, that's Antonio James. And that will be good for a first down, and the chains will move.
Well, we see Ingram getting outside the pocket, and that's what I've talked about. I think he's more successful outside of the pocket than he is sitting back there. And after the play, looking at the sideline to Coach Coe, pounding his chest, saying, let me have the ball, get me outside of the pocket, and let me make some things happen.
You sure that's what he was saying?
Yes, because I've said the same things, and I know that body language.
Hand off to Peck. The push of the line will take him all the way down to the 46. Well, you know, you talked about how they could have been possibly undefeated. You look at the games throughout the entire year, and one play here or there, and they indeed could be undefeated.
Yes, I mean, definitely some close games. We see the loss there to Miles, Arkansas Pine Bluff, who Alabama State actually beat, a tough opponent. They've had an up and down season, wins here, losses here. We see the close loss only by 4 to Clark Atlanta, so they are very close to being undefeated and possibly being 10-0.
And now the handoff to Peck, and this time he's going to be taken down in the backfield, and right there on it, number 42, Van McLeod. There you see number 12, DeChepio Woods. Has not been in the game yet. The backup for Alabama State, warming up the sideline. Maybe a bit of a better thrower than Alex Ingram is.
Well, there we saw a look at the redshirt freshman quarterback, and talking to Coach Coe, he says, you know, times throughout the season, they've wanted to keep Ingram in there, but he's been hurt, and they've been forced to go with Woods. He's improved slowly, but not as much as they would have wanted to, and that's why Ingram has been the consistent quarterback for this team.
Third down long, Ingram sprints out. He has a man open and overthrows his intended receiver. That's Cray down there. And if it would have been on target, probably would have been another interception for Hannah.
And this is a corner route here for ASU. The one thing Alex Ingram does not see is the corner out there, Justin Hannah, coming off. He was in a deep cover two bail. He was sitting on the sideline. Ingram never saw him, tried to fit it in there. He's lucky that pass wasn't intercepted.
And Alex Ingram asking for water. And it's been a long afternoon for both of these quarterbacks. Fourth down, 7. Alabama State will punt. Ashun Jackson. Back
back to receive the punt. The end-over-end kick will land at the 14. Jackson will let it roll out of bounds, and it will do so inside the 10, so a successful pooch punt, and Tuskegee will have a long way to go. We're early in the fourth at the Turkey Day Classic. We're back. There you see both quarterbacks from Alabama State talking it over at the break as they will watch as the Tuskegee offense is back out onto the field. And big kids, little kids, all kinds of kids spending their Thanksgiving at the Turkey Day Classic. Little Alabama State fans, it's never too early to get your kids started. Kevin Hupp, a nice touch to the far side. He has a man open and completed out there that time. Lorenzo Crawford on the catch. He turns it upfield and a nice big gain on first down to get them out of the shadows of their end zone.
And I'm telling you, Kevin Hupp, when he sits tall in that pocket, steps into his passes, delivers a very nice football. We've seen that deep out route on the boundary, over the defender's head, thrown many times today. When he sits in there and steps to his target, he's been on point every time.
We're under 12 minutes. Clock begins to run as the chains move. Four wideouts for Kevin Hupp. Ball at the 34. Looking at the corner blitz. It's picked up. But Kevin Hupp just gets the ball away, and it's completed to Crawford again. This time, though, it's going to be completed behind the line of scrimmage. His knee goes down, and it'll be a loss of two. But Kevin Hupp did a great job of just getting the ball away.
Yes, nice job by Hupp getting outside, avoiding that pressure, and at least getting the ball off. Even if it was incomplete, he would still negated that pressure, not taking a 7 to 10 yard loss. You see, he takes a shot there, but the important thing for the senior quarterback is that he got it out of his hands and did not take a big loss for his offense.
So after the 2 yard loss, it'll be second down and 12 for the Golden Tigers. And again, the traditional, at least for Tuskegee, traditional four wideout. This time they're going to go to the screen pass. Fitzhugh has some room. He's going to get up past the 40. He's hit by Dupuis, and he'll be he'll fall forward and be marked down just past the 42. It'll bring up a third down and short.
Nice call by Coach Slater, the offensive coordinator. Alabama State in a cover two bail, which means the corners are deep as well as the safeties. Less men to defend that screen pass. Nicely executed, very close to a first down for the Golden Tigers. Almost said Golden Bears. You know,
we've had so many golden and you know, different type of mascots this year. It's hard to keep them track. Hornets, Golden Tigers, Golden Bears. Third down, one. Every possession is becoming a premium. Fitzhugh gets the call, and he's going to be hit right at the line of scrimmage. We'll see where they mark it. Looked like he fell forward enough to get the first down, but the side judges, I don't think, are going to give him that spot. And I believe, if my eyes don't deceive me, it's going to bring up fourth down. And the Bears are going to be just about a half yard short. And it'll be interesting. Under 10 minutes, Chris, to play. Fourth down and one inside your own territory. What do you do?
I think you go with a quarterback sneak with Kevin Hupp. He's a big, strong quarterback. Again, we see so many teams hand it off deep or do a toss sweep. Well, you lose 3 to 5 yards when you do that. I think you give it to your playmaker, the senior quarterback, have him surge forward behind the big center in Danny Daniels.
Sponsor the first and 10 line for today's game, and Tuskegee needs a first and 10 right now.
No nose guard over the middle of the ball.
Kevin Hupp, though, will hand it off to his big man through. That's Finley, the first man through.
He got it.
Not a bad call right there. Number 32, he is big. 6 feet, 220. He's a senior. And he gets enough for the first down. The chains will move first down of 10 at the 45. And now, Chris, as the clock will begin to run here in a minute, not too many more possessions for both these teams. They've got to be successful at some point.
Well, a nice call, not a deep handoff or a toss sweep. You give it to the upback right there, which is pretty close to the line of scrimmage. A nice hole opened up by that Tuskegee offensive line, and then it's all Finley making sure he gets the first down.
Hupp now back in the shotgun formation. Takes a snap, and he throws an out pattern. This time it is completed. We'll see who he is completed to. And that's number 9, Crawford. You know, I think when we do Tuskegee next year, I'm going to tell Coach Slater, don't have all your wide receivers wear number 9, number 8, and number 5. They all look the same. They all run fast.
and all the numbers look the same.
Well, did you see Michael Coe on that tackle? He is a physical ball player.
He really is.
Sent Crawford about 4 yards into the Tuskegee bench there. He's a heck of a playmaker.
And Finley, you see on the sideline after he got that big first down on the fourth down play, has some cramps being stretched out. Alabama State appears to have jumped off sides. They did. Kevin Huff, though, has some room, and he has plenty enough for the first down. Gets inside the 40, and I'm sure that they will decline this penalty, and the chains will move. So it is indeed an offsides on Alabama State, and indeed it is declined.
Here we'll take a look at it here. Just another quarterback draw for Huff, getting what he can. And again, we see more of these penalties here in the second half. A lot cleaner second half, but not flawless as far as the penalties are concerned.
And both teams have been unable, though, Chris, to get into the end zone. The lone field goal, the only scoring here in the second half. And Huff again will call his own number. And this time, what a strong run. Continues to carry the pile. And Kevin Huff, a 9-yard rush. And he got hit about 3 yards in. And some of the Alabama State defenders are looking like the ball came out. But what a hard run by number four.
And I'm telling you, I knew he was a big, strong quarterback. That time he just pushes the end, the freshman, Byron Powell. You'll see the contact right here, head on head. And you think a defensive end is going to push the quarterback back. But there we see the opposite, Huff pushing Powell. Getting very close to another Tuskegee first down.
And again, exactly where they want to be, second down and short. Tuskegee has the Alabama State defense completely spread out, and Huff will go back to pass. This time, though, all kinds of pressure does get the ball away. There was a man out there. It was intended that time for number 8, Jason English, and Kevin Huff did another great job of getting the ball away and avoiding a big, debilitating sack that would have been.
And Tuskegee, the routes they're running right now, the packages are very long developing routes. He doesn't have the time to sit back there. The things are open, but they're opening late, and that's allowing that Alabama State defensive line to get that pressure on Kevin Huff. He just cannot sit in there and wait for those receivers to get open. Because of that pressure, it's forcing him to get outside the pocket. Lucky on that play, he gets the ball away and does not take a big loss.
Time starting to become a factor. Under 7 minutes to go. Third down and 2 for the Golden Tigers. Huff will call his own number, and he's into the open, and he may go to the house. Kevin Huff, 31 yards, touchdown. Tuskegee retakes the lead. Great blocking, great vision, and then great speed for the touchdown. Number 4, Kevin Huff, calling his own number and taking it upon himself to put Tuskegee back in the lead. Now the all-important extra point, Echeverry. Low snap, and he does get it up and through. A good job by the holder that time, Keon Davis. So Tuskegee now, with 6:15 remaining in the fourth quarter, 31-yard touchdown run by Kevin Huff. Can Alabama State respond? We'll find out. It's just getting good. The Golden Tiger faithful are happy right now. Kevin Huff just went 31 yards to the house. And they lead it now by 7. Chris, take us through it.
Well, we'll take a look at the QB draw here. Tony Pierce, defensive coordinator, thinks, hey, they've run this play a lot. They're not going to run it again. Coach Slater says, we'll run it again. And we see Huff breaking here into the secondary. Let's roll it. There's no one there. They have the safeties wide. And the speed of Kevin Huff is enough to outrun that Bama State defense. Nice play call by Coach Slater.
And now Foster is back to take the kickoff for Alabama State. And a flag will come in as there is a face mask. We'll see if that is the 5-yard or 15-yard variety. And now the both teams starting to get a little frisky. Getting late in the game, frustration setting in. And the reality of the fact that this is the one game, Chris, all year that both teams' point to, and neither one of these teams want to lose this one.
Yeah, I'm telling you, they talk about how players for both of these teams are friends off the field, but at the same time, they're enemies, especially when they play at this game. And you take a look at this rivalry with Tuskegee and Alabama State, this is really where it can be houses divided. You have a lot of families where maybe the husband went to Tuskegee, the wife went to Alabama State. It provides a great environment and a great rivalry with these two universities being so close together. You get a lot of families where the houses definitely are divided.
Well, Chris, I mean, you and I were divided coming into the game. I mean, you wanted Tuskegee, I wanted Alabama State. You wanted to eat, you know, 45 minutes away, I wanted to eat in town, you know, so many things. So now the 5-yard variety on the face mask. And again, more flags. And so the 5 yards they gain on the face mask, they will lose on the false start. This has been, without a doubt, safe in saying this, one of the, probably of all the games we've had this year, Chris, with the least flow. Because of all the penalties.
But it's been a classic, and that's why they call it the Turkey Day Classic.
It's always a classic, man.
This is
You're
a right. classic right here.
What was I thinking? First down, 15.
I think that's part of the plan. Make the game slow because it's a big day. You want the fans to get their right. money's worth. Let's let them stay here as long as they possibly can.
Ingram makes the run up the middle. He keeps himself. Didn't fool anybody. Four different Tuskegee defenders were there to stop Ingram, second down and long.
And it's no secret what this Tuskegee defense is doing. Defensive coordinator Reginald Ruffin is going to bring those defenders up close, shut down that running game, and Jay Peck. And that's why I think you've got to continue to get Alex Ingram outside of the pocket. He has not been very effective sitting in that pocket. Right now we see 5 wide receivers, no running backs, so you know the Hornets are going to the air.
Second, 16. Ingram back to pass. Ingram completes it to Cray on the near side. But Cray is swarmed on in a hurry and gets a minimal gain up past the 30. And at this point of the game, folks, a little over 5 minutes to play, almost a must-make third down for Alabama State.
And that's where James Cray has to catch that ball and make one move. He makes 2 moves, tries to go outside and then inside. You don't have time like that when you're going up against a talented secondary. You've got to make one move and get vertical. We'll see here, 1, 2, and the pursuit is just too fast. Cannot pick up anything extra after the catch.
Alabama State would love to end the year with a winning record. They come in 5-5, but Ingram pulls it down, and he gets up past the 35, continues to move the pile, but great pursuit, and you can see the enthusiasm on the Tuskegee sidelines by the coaches, the players, they're into it, and Alabama State is gonna have to punt.
And that's where we see Alex Ingram just doing too much, trying to do too much on that play. He had James Cray sitting on the far sideline, wide open in the flat, chose to keep it and run it, but not enough for the first down.
Great defensive pursuit by Tuskegee. Charles Coe, the head man from Alabama State, has decided not to go for it at his own 35. They still have 3 timeouts remaining, trailing by 7 and approaching 4 minutes left here in the fourth. Ashun Jackson back at his own 25. And the punt, a nice high booming punt. The fair catch by Jackson is made at his own 28. So with 3:51 remaining here in the fourth, Tuskegee gets the ball back. They are protecting a 7-point lead.
CBS Sports.
17-10, Tuskegee leading Alabama State. 3:51 remaining here in the fourth quarter. Turkey Day Classic coming to a close in dramatic fashion. Kevin Huff back at the helm in the shotgun formation. And calling his own number. And that leads us to the Xbox Live Big Play Replay. And a few moments ago, the biggest play of this game.
Well, a big quarterback draw from Kevin Huff. We see the all-out speed, athleticism of him hitting the hole there and then outrunning the Bama State secondary to get in that end zone. That is your game-changing play right there. And expect Tuskegee to keep the ball on the ground, run out as much clock as they can because they believe in their defense and that their defense is going to hold this ASU offense to not getting any more points on the board.
And the play is coming in very late to the Tuskegee huddle. The play clock is down to 6, 5, 4, And Kevin Huff may have to call a timeout or take a delay of game penalty. They just get it off. Richard Fitchue gets up past the 33. He'll be taken down right at the 33. And now whistles blow, and I believe they're going to, Alabama State will call their first timeout of this second half with a third down and about five coming up and 2:53 remaining here in this fourth quarter. They are forced now to call their timeout. Well, folks, it is time.
Give me a quarter, I'll tell you your fortune.
Gaze deeply into college football's future with the fortune tellers of CSTV's Crystal Ball, presented by Xbox Live. Join the Crystal Ball crew as they preview the last big week in Football Nation, including the SEC championship game. It's Crystal Ball, presented by Xbox Live, Wednesday night, 7 Eastern, only on CSTV.
I'm telling you, JC, I don't know where the production crew gets that soundbite from that fortune teller machine. You've seen it outside GNC in the malls, right?
I really
I don't know how we get that. It's phenomenal. Great work, Jim.
The timing's incredible, too.
Start off like you're doing it, and then come down. Don't let him get out of bounds. Get him out of bounds.
There you can see. Great stuff right there.
And there's a shot of Coach Coe. He knows that his defense needs a big turnover or a three and out. But bottom line, they've got to get the ball back for their offense if they're going to have a chance to put together a drive, which has been tough for this offense in the second half, and give them a chance to put this game in overtime.
So here we go, third down. Out of the timeout, Kevin Huff, two wide receivers. Keep an eye on number four. He calls his own number, and there he goes. But tripped up very nicely by number 36 for Alabama State. Leland Jones is the man that made the first down saving tackle. Alabama State calls another timeout, and they will indeed get the ball back.
And I'm telling you, a big play there by Leland Jones containing Kevin Huff, because if he got by there, he was going to have a first down and probably much, much more. We see the little fake draw up the middle and then a quarterback keep. Nice job by Jones containing the senior quarterback.
Leland Jones is the man right now, and now trailing by seven. Let's reset it for you. 2:39 remaining here in this fourth quarter. Tuskegee leads it by seven. Chris Ricks, I'm Jonathan Coachman. This is the 83rd annual Turkey Day Classic. This is CSTV. Just the beginning of a big weekend of sports on college sports television.
And we saw a shot there, right there, of Kevin Huff frustrated, slamming his helmet into the ground. Not the kind of body language you would expect from the quarterback that's leading his team right now with a 7-point lead. But he knows if he could have gotten that first down, that would have iced this ball game.
And I mentioned a big weekend of sports. Well, folks, fierce rivalries and crucial showdowns mark our doubleheader this weekend in Football Nation. First, bragging rights are on the line at 3:30 Eastern on Saturday when the BYU Cougars and the Utah Utes face off in the annual Holy War. Then at 7:30, we head down to Hattiesburg for a key Conference USA matchup between Marshall and Southern Miss. It's a full day of football action. You know the drill right here, CSTV. Football, basketball, this is the absolute best time of year when the sports overlap.
Oh yeah, definitely.
You gotta have your football hat on one day, your basketball shorts on the next. Oh, huge play. Tuskegee looks like they're gonna go for it. A flag does indeed come in as the play clock was down to zero. Tuskegee looking to draw Alabama State offsides. Didn't work. They'll back it up five and punt it away.
And I don't know how you have a delay of game penalty on that coming outside of that timeout. You've got to be better prepared to see that delay of game. Now, Tuskegee obviously going to have to punt the ball. We'll see what kind of field position Alabama State can get, but they're going to have good field position with only 2.5 minutes remaining.
Well, it's sprinting onto the field, both teams, and Alabama State nearly got caught off guard. Michael Coe back for the punt return. He's got some room up the middle. A flag comes in. And the return is up past the 45, and there's a flag laying back at the 35. We'll see what that is. But right there, Tuskegee playing a little hide-and-seek, so to speak, with their punt team, and nearly caught Alabama State off guard and off the field. You can see right here a block in the back by Alabama State, and that's going to cost them about 25 yards in field position. Tuskegee leading at 17-10. He is Chris Ricks. He is Chris Ricks there. I'm Jonathan Coach. We're so pleased you can join us for the 83rd annual Turkey Day Classic. And really, we knew it was going to be competitive, and it's lived up to his billing. Not pretty, but competitive.
Yes, and right now Coach Co is going to have to go to the passing game, get Alex Ingram outside of the pocket. They don't have the luxury right now to give the ball to Jay Peck, even though he's been a little more dependable. They've got to go to there and get it done. This is gut check time for Alabama State.
Gut check time indeed, as Alabama State probably in all likelihood with only one timeout left, their last chance to tie this ball game up. Ingram has a man wide open on the near side. That's Cray. Cray makes the catch, good for a first down, and does get out of bounds with 2:04 remaining here in the fourth quarter. The chains will move.
And a nice job by the Hornet offense getting the ball on the edges. The deep comeback on the sideline out there. Ingram delivers a nice ball. They've got to keep that pressure off him, not force anything over the middle where there's a lot of traffic. Try to take advantage of this one-on-one coverage up top and down below.
So now shotgun. Ingram again stays in the pocket. All kinds of time. Pack a lot. Ingram now out of the pocket, and instead of throwing the ball away, he's going to take now about an 8-yard loss back to the 30. And just not a smart play from Ingram, and we've seen that a few times today where he just, for some reason, doesn't make smart plays.
Well, Ingram got very comfortable back there. That's the most time he has had all day. Not a big rush being put on right now by the Tuskegee defensive line, dropping everyone back in coverage, trying to shut down that passing game, and he figures, hey, let me run and try to get something. Unfortunately, that Tuskegee defense closes down and forces him to get outside. Fortunately for the Hornet offense, he gets out of bounds and stops that clock.
What do the coaches usually say? It's all about time and place. Know your time, know the place in the field. Ingram isn't right now, and Ingram is going to go down, throw it away. And I believe he was out of the pocket, so there won't be intentional grounding, but great pressure. Great pressure down there by Atron Jackson. Ingram threw it away, third down and long.
Well, you see the first play of the drive, getting the ball out of his hands quickly. The last two plays, having him sit in the pocket, wait for those routes to progress. I don't see why he don't continue to get the ball out of his hands quickly, being how effective that has been. The offensive line just has not been holding up here in the second half, and vice versa. I think you've got to give a lot of credit to the Tuskegee defensive line and applying that pressure to Alex Ingram.
And all Chris Dupuis can do on the sideline is watch and hope that somehow his offense can get into the end zone in the final 1 minute and 49 seconds. So third down and long. Ingram standing in there again, pulls it down again. Looking for somebody, and he's going to launch it. He's got a couple of guys down there, but he's going to be intercepted again. Intercepted by Justin Hanna again, and Hanna will take it back to the 40. Still on his feet. He's going to go down at midfield, and number 14 has been a nemesis. And again, Ingram just threw it up for grabs, and that should just about do it. Tuskegee wrapping up the 83rd annual Turkey Day Classic.
And what a tough break for the redshirt sophomore quarterback in Alex Ingram. He had James Cray wide open going down the middle of the field. I thought he was going to hit him with a bullet, being how wide open he was, get him the ball quickly. He just simply throws this ball up. You see Cray right there, uncovered, but he throws it up with too much air behind Cray, where he has to make an adjustment. And you see Hanna back there for the interception. Tough break for the young quarterback.
And the crowd begins to file out of the Crimson Bowl here in Montgomery, Alabama. And the victory formation for Tuskegee, as Alabama State only has one timeout. And they will use it right here. But Coach Willie Slater hired in January of this year. A man with over 25 years of collegiate coaching experience. And he talked about how important this game was. And Chris, you talked about it at the beginning of the game. They ask him, can you beat Alabama State? That's the only question we won't answer.
Yes, and we see a very stern look on Coach Slater's face right there. But you know inside he's smiling because he knows at least for a year he can keep his job knowing that he beat Alabama State.
You know that inside that man and as the Tuskegee band begins to play, and the Tuskegee crowd is jubilant, to say the least. So it'll be 2 years in a row now. Hard-fought victories, winning last year in overtime, and winning this year courtesy of a 31-yard touchdown run late here in the fourth quarter by number four, Kevin Huff, the veteran quarterback and
Certainly Alabama State has given it everything that they had. Well, folks, coming up next, join us for a very special edition of the number one college sports show. Greg Amsinger and the crew will be counting down the all-time top turkey plays in the history of college football as voted by you, the fans. What will be number one? FSU's wide right field goal. Or maybe the Cal Stanford man last second touchdown. Tune in at 5 to find out. And I promise, I didn't write that.
Who put that together?
I didn't write it. I just read it. It was kind of fun to read that. And the clock will run.
Well, a big game with Florida this weekend.
Yep. You're going to be there, right?
We'll be there at the game. Hopefully this one doesn't come down to a kick.
Well, certainly that'd be a huge win for the Seminoles if they could pull out a victory against Florida.
Oh, yeah.
One of the premier teams this year.
Take the Gators out of that national title hopes they have down in Gainesville.
And of course, here on CSTV, BYU, another top 25 team. They'll be in action Saturday afternoon. Well, that's going to do it. As the clock runs down, Willie Slater and Tuskegee pull out the Turkey Day Classic. And the feeling right now on the sideline of the Golden Tigers has to be something of severe accomplishment. Once again, your final score, Tuskegee 17, Alabama State 10. We'll be back with our final thoughts from Montgomery right after this.
On radio.
HBCU football presented by the U.S. Navy. Tuskegee and Alabama State has been brought to you by the U.S. Navy. Navy, accelerate your life. By Aflac. Aflac, ask about it at work. By Sirius Satellite Radio. Hear the sports, talk, news, entertainment, and 100% commercial-free music that you want. Sirius Satellite Radio. The best radio on radio. And by Xbox Live. It's good to play together. Well, very quickly, let's take a look at the Sirius player of the game. And who else is it going to be but Kevin Huff from Tuskegee?
And it's got to be Kevin Huff. The way he played this football game, the savvy leader, the playmaker for Tuskegee. Over 200 yards passing and running. We saw a lot of big plays. One passing touchdown earlier in the game, and then a 31-yard rushing touchdown on the quarterback draw in the second half. He made the plays for this Tuskegee offense, led them, got frustrated at times, but at the end of the day came through and got the victory.
Well, once again, our final score, Tuskegee 17, Alabama State 10. For Chris Ricks and our entire CSTV crew, I'm Jonathan Coachman. For more, log on to CSTV.com, the ultimate destination for scores, news, highlights, and analysis. This has been a presentation of CSTV College Sports Television, the 24-hour college sports network from CBS Sports. So long from Montgomery, Alabama, the Crampton Bowl. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody.
Football's a way of